Tuesday, the 30th day of June, 2015. We're now way past half the year. We are going to be having Naomi Prinz, former managing director of Goldman Sachs, on with us. She left Goldman Sachs back in 2002, warning in several New York Times best-selling books about exactly what was coming in the future. She's not somebody that's leaving now and criticizing the system so they don't get prosecuted. She left 13 years ago, and she worked directly under the head of the entire company. Even more powerful, some estimate, than J.P. Morgan Chase. At the top of the pyramid, there's no debate. There are two horses that pull the New World Order at the very head of it. It's Goldman Sachs and J.P. Morgan. And she was directly under, kind of like the Darth Vader to Emperor Palpatine. There's a lot of managing directors at Goldman Sachs. Not a lot, but quite a few. She was a managing director directly under, serving directly under a top lieutenant to one of the Dark Lords. And so that's all coming up today with the continued accelerated meltdown in Europe that ties into the entire planetary economy. And again, we keep talking about this for the last few months, the huge buildup for something big. Does that mean it's about to happen? I don't like the bubble. I wish we weren't in a bubble. I'll be honest. I want the bubble to keep expanding at a fleshly level because I don't want to see a depression slash global meltdown. But it's true. The bigger the bubble gets, the worse it's going to be. It's kind of like we're on a cliff that just keeps getting higher. It's being thrust up out of the ground, and I don't want to have to jump off. But the longer we wait, the further we've got to jump. And we don't have a parachute. And at a certain point, the fall is going to be so great that it's going to be fatal. So there's another allegory. We have Congressman Ron Paul joining us, former Congressman Thursday with huge news. Jesse Ventura is also joining us Thursday. We have a lot of big guests coming up throughout the week. When we come back, I'm going to launch into all the news, and it is extremely important, obviously. We will also be looking at maniac police today in the U.S. and why are they recruiting people that behave like this? Some of the most amazing footage of maniac cop straps handcuffed man to a chair and tortures him for resisting, even when the other cops are telling him to stop. And how this ties into the mindset of the controllers themselves. Top scientists are saying another mega earthquake could be getting ready to hit the San Andreas Fault out on the West Coast. But I said I'd play this yesterday, and I want to get to it today. One of the top analysts and fund managers out there, incredible record of accuracy, Jim Rogers, warning about the Greece situation. Here it is.
How is that going to affect the economy there?
Well, of course it's going to affect it badly. If you cannot get any money, you cannot spend it. And we are not reverting to a barter economy yet anyway. But no, of course, the Greek economy is going to collapse this week and probably for a while. People are terrified, and you would be too. So would I.
What about the overall picture here? Greece blames the EU for the debt crisis, but its finances and policies have been in a really bad state since joining the euro, really. Surely you should take some responsibility.
You know, the Greek economy has been in a bad shape for about 190 years. This goes back to when they became independent a long time ago. No, you're exactly right. This economy has been having recurrent crises since they joined the EU. This has been going on for several years now. If you ask me, what they should do is just go ahead and go bankrupt.
That's right.
Get it over with and start over.
All right, we're going to go to break.
Calling names.
Here's the issue. All of our countries are bankrupt by design. We've been maneuvered into this, and once you collapse like Greece or Mexico or Argentina, you hardly ever come back because the globalists never let you get out of it. You should just let it all fold, then rebuild. But they don't do that. They never write off the debt. They deal deception. They deal diversions. They deal distractions. They deal in mental illness, fraud, and failure. They deal in dishonor. They deal in delusion. They deal in despotism. They deal in a doctrine of failure for humanity so they, the alchemists of tyranny, can rule over the lobotomized sheep. I don't know about you, but I don't like that. I like freedom. I like the wild, wild west of laissez-faire, renaissance, and human empowerment. This is the global slave revolt worldwide by humans of every race, color, and creed that wish to be free. Their divide and conquer strategy must be exposed if we are to thrive and move to the next level of God's plan. We deal in truth here. We deal in justice. We deal in breaking the population out of its trance. Let me just do this. I've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 21 stacks of news. Not to mention what I've got up on the computer at Infowars.com, PrisonPlanet.com, and over here on DrudgeReport.com. Let me just go over these headlines for you. Where should I start? Just look at this headline out of Time Magazine. This is what World War III will look like. We're going to cover that story. That's just one stack. The top story on one stack. Another headline. Amid Puerto Rico debt woes, reality hits San Juan streets. They announce they're going default. I'm sure they deserve it because the media told us so, just like Greece. And just like you'll deserve to have part of your private bank account taken to save the economy and the next banker bailout. And they'll have the media tell you it's all your fault, even though you've paid your bills and paid 70% of what you make in one form of taxes or the other. It doesn't matter. U.S. top court rules against Obama administration over air pollution rule. Obama issues 19 classified directives changing laws passed by Congress. Not only now does the president act as a dictator in most cases, but the dictatorial edicts are secret. You can't get more Kafka or 1984-esque. Award-winning comedian says politically correct left has killed comedy. And, you know, I want the guys and the gals back there to grab the three clips here because I never played Seinfeld a month ago. Jerry Seinfeld, amazing comic and a liberal, by the way, coming out and saying there's a fascist threat to freedom in America from political correctness. Well, we got Bill Maher saying the same thing. I mean, that guy's a tyrant and a half. I mean, what, you're criticizing about your victories? That's what this is language-ending, freedom-ending garbage. But there's three clips of top comedians in here talking about how horrible it is. I thought we'd play some of those because there's some new clips plus the one I mentioned. Rand Paul raised money with marijuana industry in Denver. I love how the left all loves Obama, who promised to legalize marijuana and then doubled the raids on dispensaries and lawsuits and crackdowns conservatively that Bush had against states legalizing medical marijuana. And it's not that Paul's some doper. It's that he realizes that you end up making it a black market, empowering criminals when you have marijuana illegal. You decriminalize it, then you can tax it and control it and control the quality. And yes, that is his big crime he admits to. The big secret in college is he would take good-looking girls down to the river in Waco and smoke pot with them. Oh, my gosh. That's why the left hates him. Because he won't throw them in prison, and he wants to get rid of the phony drug laws. You want a Democratic Party founded by the Klan that wants your guns and wants to put you in prisons. Doesn't matter if in Democratic-controlled states and cities, blacks have the highest per capita incarceration rate. It doesn't matter. You love it because you want to imagine you're the liberal and imagine you're the winner. Oh, I'm sorry. I haven't gone through all the stacks yet. I'm just giving you this top story in each stack. Could LA's big one be even bigger than we thought? Now we have explosive new information. Helium is leaking from massive earthquake fault under Los Angeles. And when that starts happening, the animals start running out of the area, and, well, you know what happens next. And it's the only area on the Ring of Fire globally, even the U.S. Geological Survey admits this, that has not triggered yet. You've been seeing all the massive earthquakes the last 8 years on the Ring of Fire all the way around the Pacific. And those plates, the only place that has it triggered is right there, and it's 2 years overdue. But that's okay. Just say it's a conspiracy theory that we are on big plates floating on an ocean of magma, and just say it doesn't exist. Don't say that the Yellowstone isn't rising and lowering in different areas, and that Mount St. Helens is now becoming a little more active than it was. It's been, quote, dormant. Now they're arguing whether it's becoming active again. Oh, it's active. Remember what Mount St. Helens did? In fact, you can go on YouTube and get footage of Mount St. Helens' eruption. But you know what? None of this matters. What matters is Confederate flags and Caitlyn Jenner. So that's coming up. And a new WikiLeaks document reveals NSA spied on top French companies. Yeah. And it's not like it's spied on the companies to give it to U.S. companies. They give it to globalist companies and then move it to China, move it to India. And that's one reason you have to pretty much move to China or India, because the globalists have development zones with those corrupt, basically oligarchies, whatever you want to call them, tyrannies. India is a tyranny as well. Not like as bad as China, but it's a tyranny. And they go there because you have to work with the globalist, or they won't ever let you basically bring anything to market. That's what globalism is. They don't just rig things with cheap labor and with internal tariffs against Western goods and the taxes and all the rest of it. They don't let you operate, and they move your stolen designs to China where no one can stop them, and they put you out of business. That's the plan for world government. And if you try to have an economy and try to become free market and try to reform yourself from a communist totalitarian command and control regime like Russia, they send in over 300 NGOs and spend $25 billion in the last decade trying to collapse Russia. And then if Russia doesn't like it and kicks the admitted certified foreign spies out, they'll arrest them. Russia's called totalitarian. Let me tell you, if they got Russian spies running around trying to overthrow my country, I see any of them, I'm going to punch them in the nose. See, I'm a sovereign nationalist, folks. I believe in a free country that I defend. And I've got skin in the game. This corrupt, disgusting, decadent, bloated, diseased, demonically possessed country is a shell of its former self, but I still love it and want to resuscitate it. And then I see the globalists that have destroyed us trying to destroy Russia, and it makes me sick. And I do feel a kinship with anyone being preyed upon by these people, like I do for Christians in Syria or in Iraq or in Libya or in Egypt, where our filthy, evil globalist controllers, our occupiers, are funding the prosecution of an ethnic cleansing operation against Christians. I feel kinship with anybody under attack from our enemy, because we're under attack. These are the people that feed us GMO and put glyphosate in our water supply and hydrofluorocystic acid and put our kids on all these drugs. We are under attack. This is a world government already in place, playing countries off against each other, sucking them dry, sucking all the energy and wealth and patents and creativity and brains, all the brain trust up into its globalist panopticon motherships that are above the law. The city of London, Washington, D.C., New York City, the Vatican, Israel. And I'm not saying the Vatican's totally bad, or Israel's totally bad, or New York's totally bad, or D.C.'s totally bad, or the city of London's totally bad, or the U.N.'s totally bad. What do all these groups have? They're above the law, sovereign, diplomatic immunity, and allow the globalists to have redoubts. Switzerland. Let's list all of them. Luxembourg, Monte Carlo, Grand Cayman, Cook Islands, the Vatican, Switzerland, Israel, City of London, District of Columbia. Above the law, diplomatic immunity, their own systems, and above it all, the United Nations and the IMF, the World Bank, the International Bank of Settlements, the Exim Bank, all run by the same 200 people or so. Establishing this whole program, bringing America down, bringing Russia down, bringing China down, siphoning off all the energy of the hardworking Chinese to help bankrupt all the other nations, playing us all off against each other in a symphony of destruction. And once you understand the enemy program and the attack profile, they can be defeated. World government and the central banks are our mortal enemies, not other countries, not other races, not other peoples. For those out there that think we live in boring times, you must be asleep at the switch. We live in incredibly dynamic, dangerous times. And many times over the years, I've been out with friends on their boats, water skiing. For years, I had a Glastron ski boat, but never had time to go out and use it, so I got rid of it. But there'd be a few times I was out on it, and my dad was driving, or I was driving, and a boat turned when the lake was busy, or I was getting near a sandbar, and somebody says, "Hey, look out. You know, you're 200 yards from land." Or, "Look out for that boat. Look out for that sailboat." And I didn't get mad at them and say, "You're an alarmist, you're a fearmonger," even though most of the time I was already turning back from getting a soft drink or whatever behind me, or telling one of my kids not to, you know, stand up in the back. Whatever the distraction was, I'd be turning back. I had usually already turned. I was already making a turn. But still, it was good that they were watching. Well, what if your dad said, "Hey, look out, you're going towards the land," or "Look out for that boat." And I said, "Be quiet, conspiracy theorist. It's not good to have your eyes open. It's not good to be vigilant, even though the price of liberty is eternal vigilance. Just go to sleep." You would run into the land at 50 miles an hour and probably kill everybody. Or you'd run into somebody else's boat and kill them. And politically, we've watched the social engineers, the globalists who've announced themselves as the enemy of humanity, that's how arrogant they are, destroy nation after nation, suck them dry, and tell us how they deserved it. And now they're setting the West up for an economic depression and financial consolidation that will make the Great Depression pale in significance. And I'm simply here saying, strap yourselves in, make preparations, get ready for a crash landing. I hope we can get the plane up and it doesn't hit the ground. I hope we pull out of this and it's just a global recession. But that's not what the controllers want. They want a controlled, engineered, global collapse. And the only way they're going to back off is if it's exposed that they're in control and they stand to gain and that they've engineered this, which has come out in the IMF and World Bank documents. It's come out in the Financial Times of London, CNBC, you name it, that they do run things and that they are consolidating power and taking over their competition and being bailed out via too big to fail during these crises. It is a fact. Should I play CNBC again with their panel of five people, including the host, all agreeing that we're slaves to central bankers? While we're busy digging up Confederate war generals and trying to rename military bases and trying to ban the sale of flags at Walmart, we are becoming true slaves to a cashless society, high-tech system that jacks our food and water and is 10 times more scientific and evil than the most wicked slave master of the past. I mean, hands down, the current major threat. Let's just say they were as evil as evil slave owners. Would we obsess over the old slave owners who aren't in front of our eyes, or will we obsess over the new ones? We would obsess over the new ones. But see, we're all told to obsess over things that don't matter. So while we live in la-la land and fight with each other like a group of idiots, the establishment is completing the final stages of their planetary takeover. We stand at the precipice. Now, we're going to go to break. I'm going to come back and hit our most important current news. And that, of course, is the former CIA head said, "I wouldn't be surprised if terror attacks hit the U.S. over the 4th of July weekend." We have the video, and that ties into some other important reports. Then we're going to expand back into what's happening in the Middle East and how that ties together. Then what's happening with the European central banks that actually own our Federal Reserve. Then we're going to look at what World War III would look like from Time Magazine and more. Plus, vicious videos of psychopathic police attacking restrained prisoners.
We're on the march.
Most dangerous place to be on the world stage is in the bleachers. Because the bleachers are where the wolves are actually feeding on the sheep. It's on the field, in the sun, shining at high noon, that men and women who want justice and freedom are strongest. Not in the dark bleachers. Not up where the establishment tells you it's safe, but on the field. We're going to get into this terrorism news and more here in a moment. Naomi Prinz, former managing director, Goldman Sachs, huge whistleblower, 2002, 2003, written multiple best-selling nonfiction books and fiction books dealing with the banking collapse that's coming. She's going to be joining us in the second hour. Now, we've got amazing breakdown, special report we're going to do live on air. I've done a lot of research for it. In the third hour, on the attack on the human brain and how it's done by design. That's coming up in the third hour with Anthony Gucciardi in studio with me. I want to make this announcement now. It's going up as we speak, a day early. I wanted to launch it a day and a half early. It will run through the month of July. We've never done this before for an entire month. We usually only do it in the last 2 weeks before Christmas. Free shipping on all products across the board at InfoWarsStore.com that we ship out of these offices. And that's 90%+ of the products. Stuff like water filters and things are drop shipped from Michigan directly from their factory. The Probe Pure G2 systems and things like that. But Life Straws, things like that, are all shipped from here. All of the InfoWars Life products, everything at InfoWarsStore.com, InfoWarsLife.com is free shipping. And that includes stuff that has current specials, like 25% off all the Molon Labe Made in America belt buckles. 25% off that and a whole bunch of other stuff at Made in 1776.com to celebrate the month of July and freedom. Super deals for our listeners who've helped make so much what we do here possible. InfoWarsLife.com, Made in 1776.com, InfoWarsStore.com is just the blanket umbrella site. It's got all these subsection sites where we have the Made in America apparel, where we have the high-quality water filtration, where we have the InfoWars non-GMO heirloom seed center. Lowest prices, one of the widest selections out there. We're free market. We're competitive. Free shipping and all the specials that are currently there. And you notice I keep saying we've never had specials this good. I began to get more involved in marketing the last few years. I just used to just put stuff up there and hope it paid the bills. And as we tweak things and as we get even more hardcore free market, we just get more successful by the grace of God. And they say necessity is the mother of invention. We've expanded InfoWars. I have a bigger nut to crack every month with payroll and servers and the building and the equipment and all of it. And so I've set out to not let the media intimidate me that being successful is bad when they wish they were successful. And we are, by the grace of God, sustaining ourselves and growing a little bit. So I'm doubling down, hiring more reporters, more editors, more video people. You've heard the announcements. That's a job in itself. Going through the folks and hiring them will probably add between 5 and 10 people. I'm looking at our budget. But we know it's up to us to really take on the globalist, be able to send reporters all over the world. I want to be able to send reporters to Europe to track this collapse that's going on that will undoubtedly lead to here. But that takes money. I'm tempted to go to Europe for a week or so and go to Greece and go to Spain, where I believe the next collapse is coming, and most analysts do, and to go to England, the city of London, where they actually run the thing, and to go to Rome, where they've installed the, you know, the leader of Rome is a former Goldman Sachs director. I mean, this is world events that are happening. The globalist, 100 years in the making, and it's coming to a head. It is legendary. It is over the top. It is epic. It is historical. All those words don't bring justice to it when you realize how wicked the globalists are. But getting back to the specials, we are sold out of five items at InfoWarsLife.com, the liver cleanse, so many other things. We're launching a new product in the fourth hour that's now gone up on the shopping cart. I'm not going to even talk about it until that point comes, because I'm going to be breaking it down as well. So InfoWarsLife.com, free shipping, month of July, starts now. It's now up right now. Store-wide free shipping through July, starting at the end of June. Toll-free number to call to ask questions, to ask about different specials, 888-253-3139, 888-253-3139. And the shipping address is also at InfoWars.com. And if you can, blow that up for me on screen. I'll read that address out for folks. P.O. Box 19549, Austin, Texas, 78760. P.O. Box 19549, Austin, Texas, 78760. I give that P.O. Box out maybe once every 3 months. I should give it out every day. To the point of I don't even have it memorized. I mean, that's shameful. But what I do have memorized is the globalist attack profile and what they're doing. So there's the announcement. A whole bunch of sales across the board and free shipping the entire month of July. Take advantage of that. And we need to get the capital in. I've signed the deals for the satellites. That starts in the next couple months. I have signed a bunch of other deals we'll be announcing and that take expenditures. In the face of the globalist onslaught, we're just going to go 110%. Because the old rule in football rings true. It's the play that you don't go 100%+. When I was a kid, I used to hear 110% and think that doesn't exist. But in the human body, it does. We have a governor where most people can actually go 200% or 300% when it comes to weightlifting or things like that. There's another 10% when it comes to running. That's really true. That you have a governor in you that keeps you at what you think is 100%, so you never even get near the 100%. But you decide to shoot for 150%, that's how you trick the brain to go to 110. So the globalists are doubling down right now because they're in trouble. But they're dangerous, and we're not beating them. We finally are contending with them in a death struggle. I mean, we're in a fight. They're bloodied. We're bloodied. It's on. You got to go 110%. Don't worry about getting hurt, because the minute you get intimidated, the minute you don't go 110%, the minute you don't switch on and get in the zone, is the minute you're going to get run over and hurt. We got to commit spiritually and intellectually to go 110% against these people and to not be cowards. So I'm not mincing words. I'm not pulling back. I'm not holding reserves. I'm all in. I'm not worried about nothing. Because before my God and my family, I'm going to be a real human and a real American like my ancestors, and I'm not going to be a coward. I'm going all in, everything. All in, because let me tell you, this is the moment. We're entering the next few years and the decade after that. But it's not, hey, it's coming. Hey, the event horizon. Hey, the threshold is close. That I've been telling you for years. We now are crossing the line. We're now steaming into the waters, folks. And there be monsters. Get ready. Sea monsters, to use the sea analogy, that have already wrecked countless nations and killed hundreds of millions of people. We are now in their territory. They've now come to us, and they claim this is their territory. The only reason we have any basic freedom, the only reason we have any basic private property, is ancestors 800 years ago were willing to stand up against the power elite, were willing to stand up against the establishment, and were willing to die so that they had basic freedoms. And out of Magna Carta grew everything we see today. That merged with Judaic and Christian law, which were very similar to British common law, and gave us what we have today. And there's been a fight to bring in Roman law, Babylonian law. Law of the kings ever since. And we're here now. We've now come to the crossroads. We're now at the crossroads. We're now at that magic moment in history. 800 years of Magna Carta on the 16th of this month, a week and a half ago. This will be a day long remembered. You can feel it in your bones. You can see it in the streets. You can see it in the news. You can see it unfolding everywhere. We're in a death battle. And I just cannot stress that to people enough. We are in a death battle. Excellent science fiction movie. Came out a year and a half, 2 years ago. Oblivion. Not even a fan of Tom Cruise, but it was excellent. Until they got to the cheesy, you know, classic Hollywood ending stuff. And I'll give you this allegory again. And I'm going to spoil the movie for you if you haven't seen it right now. It's basically 80-something years, if I go from memory, after the moon gets hit by a giant asteroid and blown into pieces. That causes earthquakes, seas to flood, breakdown. But then the surviving humans, after 90-plus percent die from starvation and war over the resources that are left, a decade later, ships land and astronauts, copies of astronauts that were picked up by the spaceship coming in, you know, light years out, have mass replicated them and drones and attack the survivors. And the survivors are programmed and still believe that they're basically astronauts who are fueling their spaceship up in orbit. It's a big pyramid, three-sided pyramid. And it's sucking the oceans up and has these big factories built on the ground that they use drone humans, humanoids, to build. And they think they're actually, you know, just leaving the Earth. They don't know they're actually there killing the Earth and sucking up the water to turn it into hydrogen propellant to send the parasite robot AI off to the next planet. And it's the greatest allegory I've ever seen, because that's what the New World Order does. It floats above the Earth, above the law, a globalist operation. The people serving it think they're trying to save the Earth and bring global peace, and the elite have decided to merge with machines and become God and leave the planet. And they've got all these people that have drone programming and might as well be clones working for each other. A year before Oblivion even came out, I designed a graphic that I said was key that described the New World Order master plan. DARPA, the real Skynet, the end of humanity, rise of the robots was the article, Infowars.com. And then, of course, you go see the movie and it's basically the same creature. And that's because it's an archetype and it's what they're manifesting. The real deal. And again, I want to be clear to the New York Times before they misinterpret this. I'm not saying it's really aliens. Humans are master builders. What we envision, we end up creating or more. The elite are envisioning this. So, of course, in movies, they're giving you revelation of the method of what they're actually planning. They believe the Earth is untenable. They're going to suck and extract resources off Elysium, another example, go off world to build their golden fields. Because they believe in the program to wipe out humanity, because we might contend with them and not let them have their master plan. They believe in that war against humanity. They may actually destroy the planet. I mean, that's how whacked out of their minds they are. And that's because the entity or the spirit or the archetype, the mass consciousness, whatever it is that's driving them, really just wants to kill the planet. Funny, the Bible says that. But they have this delusion that they're going to kill the planet and then they're going to get off of it and be okay. We're not meant to save the planet. We're meant to leave the planet. How many movies have we been told that in? No, we're meant to save the planet and beyond that. Because we decide that. We have a destiny. We're not just programmed by you, New World Order. We see your mind. We see your dreams that are nightmares to us. And they may be heavenly to you, but they're not. We don't think Hellraiser's an owner's manual. We don't think Hitler was cute, or Stalin, or the New World Order, or CIA black torture sites. We reject you. We don't want to be part of that. Now, we see the headlines from Associated Press, Zero Hedge, you name it, yesterday. Who could have foreseen it? The Greek bailout didn't work. And, of course, Zero Hedge is being sarcastic. that the media is everywhere going, who could have thought Greece would fail? Who could have thought this would have happened? Who could have thought derivatives would be a problem? Who could have thought sticking your hand in a meat grinder might not feel good? Who could have thought shooting yourself in the head with a 12-gauge wouldn't feel good? Who could have thought ISIS would have reconstituted and attacked us? I mean, Al-Qaeda was beaten after 13 years, and now they're back with a new name, the same flag, rampaging everywhere. They were the Free Syrian Army, our buddies, and now they're the enemy. Oh, but Turkey's going to invade. They've announced Syria to take out the Kurds who were fighting Al-Qaeda, known as ISIS. But don't worry. I mean, we told you over and over again, they're then going to have them attack first the Middle East, some areas of Europe. I even predicted France, North Africa. And then when they attack, they'll, quote, take our liberties away to keep us safe from the attacks. And now, like clockwork, that's happened. And they sit up there, the mind-numb public, saying, who could have imagined? Who could have thought? I mean, this is like watching paint dry. It's so easy to know what's happening. This is like, what is 2 + 2 = 4? But that's the ability to be free. That's why Obama says it equals 5. You go, but that's outrageous. They're meant to break your will. They've got to be outrageous and have the Surgeon General talking about 5-year-olds masturbating. It's meant to jack with you. It's a joke. Our gross domestic product is now an Olympic man who's turned into a woman. Who cares? How's that going to save us from AI? How does that give us the answer to the unified field theory? I don't care. I don't hate you. I don't love you. I don't care. Stop forcing your weirdness on me. Sex, I mean, it'd be like if they had the potty poop party or something where everybody talked about, I can go to the bathroom wherever I want or something. Sexual and bodily functions is only one part of me. I'm pointed at the stars. I'm pointed at incredible discoveries. I'm pointed at humans actualizing the power to instantaneously create as our creator has given us the power to grow into. That's what I'm into. Not having our destiny taken control of and being run into the ground. Can you imagine in the future if we survive this, looking back on the mind control, obsessing over dead Confederate generals and rebel flags and transvestites and trannies? I mean, can you really imagine that? What if we blow the earth up and don't make it? How are you then going to put your miniskirts on, your 70-year-old men? We're going to come back and play the former CIA deputy director saying he expects terror attacks over the 4th. While the border's wide open. Stay with us. Let's go ahead and get to the news here. Then we'll get into just over the top. It's the only word I got. There's 3 articles today on Obama power grabbing, and it's what we thought. But, I mean, it's even more inventive and wicked and evil than I thought they would do. I mean, it's just 9 times out of 10, things are worse than I say. And I used to get accused of exaggerating a lot because people didn't actually read what we were getting into. But it's on purpose to be over the top, again, to just overwhelm you and break your will. And at a genetic cellular level, it hasn't broken my will, but I just already know all this is coming. So it's almost like we can't oppose it because we've been fighting it so long, we just expect it. We've made preparation for it in our hearts and minds. And that's why they tell you what they're going to do to you, even though it can unravel their plan, is because humans are designed to adapt, evolve, overcome to their environment, even if it's a scientific takeover. So they've tricked us in an algorithm to adapt to our slavery. And I know I say that all the time because a very high-level globalist, very sickeningly, schooled me for about an hour on a 3-hour flight to New York, first class. I've told this story many times, but it's key. And I didn't even get it till I got off the plane. And he said, you think people are going to adapt when they have this information and resist? They're going to adapt to it. And he was slick, he was smart, he was good looking, he was everything. And it was just funny to him that his suit looked perfect, his overcoat looked perfect. I wouldn't even know how to look like that. And that he could just arrogantly laugh at me when he walked off the plane. And so many lay average folks would say to me, oh, yeah, you really talk to this person. They would really talk to you like that. There's a whole nother world out there when you're a, quote, journalist, a pundit, when people know you live and die by not breaking confidences, that the people will say, this is off record, right? And I'll go, yep. And they'll go, okay, you're going to fail. It's like when I had 15 years ago, his name's Thomas Barnett, I'm going from memory. He's like that one of the heads of one of the war colleges, and he'd done a C-SPAN thing about how the military works for world government, how there's a global government takeover, and how great it is, and join with Sauron, with all these top generals watching him. And he wouldn't come on once he figured out I was Alex Jones, not Alex S. Jones of the New York Times, but the other Alex Jones. And he goes, you fail. Nothing can stop us. I mean, it was almost like Emperor Palpatine to Yoda saying, you cannot win. Darth Vader will become more powerful than either of us. I mean, he was just, at first he said, this is off record, right?
Thank you for listening to GCN.
John Harmon wouldn't even hear that long ago. I forget who it was that heard that. Only the board operator heard it. And he was talking to me during the break, very threatening, very sick. I'm going to go to our next guest, but it was about 15 years ago. It was right after 9/11. A Thomas Barnett, one of the top strategists at the Army War College, you name it, he was scheduled to be a guest because I'd seen him on C-SPAN going, basically our military works for Wall Street and the global government, and just get with it and join it. And, you know, he's who the Pentagon pushes. So we get him on. He thinks I'm Alex S. Jones of the New York Times, who's a Pulitzer Prize winner of memory serves. And he starts telling, and it was John Harmon. Harmon remembers it. And he didn't say, don't be off records. The only reason I can say this, I was talking about off the record discussions. And we go to the 3-minute break. He'd just gotten him on. He figures out who it is because he got him on about a minute before I went to break. He tells Harmon, I'm not going to do this interview. Harmon says, let's talk to Alex. He conferences me into the call. I talk to him over the microphone in my headphones at the time. And I go, listen, you admit world government's taken over and that we should just join with it and all the rest of it. I want you to come on and defend it. And he goes, how dare you? You'll never stop us. Literally hissing at me. And I go, well, hey, then come on and defend your ideas. He goes, no, you pathetic fool. And I go, what, do you disagree with me when I say about you? And he goes, I go, listen, your world government's going to fail. You're not going to get us wrapped into this whole thing and this trilateral plan. He goes, that's what you think. You have nothing. You'll never stop us. I mean, it was very Palpatine-esque. And you can go to TED TV and see his big talk. That's how he acts. He's all, yes. and it's inevitable. Join with it. Oh, yes. And then I said, Harmon, was it you running the show back then? So I know you've been here about 15 years, but I couldn't remember. I knew it was right around 9/11. Thomas P.M. Barnett's Globalization, How We Join with the World Government. I mean, just type in his name, go read about it. This is just one of these guys. Just one of these guys. Harmon also heard Rothkopp. And again, he was the head of the Kissinger group at the time, and he didn't say it was off record. So Harmon heard all that where he was like, well, I thought you might want to join with us. I mean, you're a reasonable guy. You're part of the super class leading the conspiracy theorist. You know, Alex, we're just trying to build a better world, and that's why I came on. But it's obvious that I wasted my time. Harmon, did you not hear those conversations?
Absolutely. That is a true story. And we'd get these guys on the line, and they'd kind of start to change their tune once they either figured out what show they were coming on, and that your global views didn't line up with theirs exactly to the T, and they would get spooked off. And there was other times where you'd bring on a guest and his lawyer would pop on the air. Oh, you can't say that. You can't say it, and shut down the interview.
Oh, yeah. Like the time we had the director of Harp on. He goes, yes, yeah. Alex, we actually ignite the sky. Oh, by the way, I like your show. The guy was a fan, the scientist. And then the Air Force colonel comes on and shuts the interview off. By the way, we ought to find that and play it. It's like 12 years ago. It's an amazing interview. You were there for that, weren't you, Harmon?
Absolutely. They got really friendly and said, you can come up. And they invited you up there and said, we'll show you around. And we have nothing to hide.
I really should have gone. No one gets invited into HARP. And people thought that interview was fake. But it was because the technical director, the civilian director, was a listener. I mean, you can't make this stuff up, Harmon.
Yeah, this is real. I mean, this is real radio. Jones is in Austin, Texas, and I'm just at a mixing board, and I would call up a guest, get him on the line, the real guy. And I mean, this is.
Do you remember Barnett though? Basically cackling like Palpatine at me?
Absolutely. It was just like, yeah, I'm not going to do this interview. And I said, hold on the line. And as soon as we were going to break, I patched you guys in. And yeah, he just, those remarks that is just was very bizarre. He just changed his tune and hung up. So,
do you remember him going like, haha, you will be defeated?
Absolutely. Absolutely. He made some comment about how you're not going to win. And
that was it.
Hung up the phone. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, we're literally fighting with people that are taking over America and off the other like, you won't win. You'll be defeated. I mean, that's who we're fighting. These are villains, folks. She joins us for the balance of the hour. Former Goldman Sachs managing director, who worked directly under the head of Goldman Sachs. At the very top of the financial pyramid worldwide, back in the early 2000s, she basically discovered what the larger plan was and quit her very successful, lucrative job where she was rising quickly through the ranks and wrote books exposing it. And she is going to be with us for the next 52 minutes at NomiPrinz.com, and it ties into these articles, Hillary Clinton, Jeb Bush, and the big banks. Four factors behind rising volatility and how to deal with them. NomiPrinz.com. Jeb all in. The Bush dynasty and the banker friends. Go for round three. Again, she wrote the article that got picked up by papers all over the world. Nomi Prinz, Hillary, Bill, and the big six banks. They're all in the same crew. It's totally staged. We talk about Hillary and Jeb Bush. The only question is, which one is the ringer? Her new book, All the Presidents, The Hidden Alliances That Drive American Power, is already a bestseller. And she joins us. I'm going to intersperse, because I meant to get to it last hour. I haven't yet. Former CIA head said he wouldn't be surprised if terrorists didn't hit this July 4th, saying ISIS is in the country, and, quote, in our basements. Well, yeah, because you let them in, because you funded them. That was on CBS Nightly News. They create the crisis, they allow the terrorists to attack, then they offer the solution. And then we're going to get into Obama has issued 19 classified directives. So now they're not just directives that bypass Congress, they're classified. And that dovetails with Obama signs bill giving himself fast-track powers for trade deals. We'll get Nomi's take on that. U.S. justices turn down states over voter registration restrictions right as they ship in record numbers of illegals. So the plan is pretty clear. It's all coming up in this hour. In the third hour, I'm going to get to a bunch of special reports dealing with the attack on the human brain. Believe me, those articles are legion, and we'll have some calls then as well. I'm not going to go over her whole bio because it's lengthy, but she received her BS degree from mathematics from SUNY, purchased an MS degree in statistics from New York University. Before becoming a journalist, Nomi worked on Wall Street as a managing director at Goldman Sachs and ran the International Analytics Group, see that's why it's key, at Bear Stearns in London. She's a member of the Senator Bernie Sanders Federal Reserve Reform Advisory Council and listed as one of America's top wonks on the Federal Reserve. She's a senior fellow at the nonpartisan public policy think tank Demos. And her latest book is All the President's Bankers, with Jim Rogers and others saying that Greece is collapsing this week. I want to play that clip. And with CNBC admitting we're all slaves to international banks, central banks, this is a designed program where they build it too big to fail, set up the system, and have a cascade of collapses that consolidate world power until they appoint the leaders of Greece. They appoint the leaders of Italy. They appoint the leaders in Latin American countries. And they basically select the leaders here. That's all coming up. But first, here's Jim Rogers.
How is that going to affect the economy there?
Well, of course, it's going to affect it badly. If you cannot get the money, you cannot spend it. And we are not reverting to a barter economy yet anyway. But no, of course, the Greek economy is going to collapse this week and probably for a while. People are terrified, and you would be too. So would I.
Nomi,
what about the overall picture here? Greece.
We see the very same preparations they made in Greece before the bank holiday, the not letting folks get their money out, or 66 euros a day being set up all over the Western world. We see elites ringing the alarm bell so they can act like they warned us, but you warned us, I guess, 14 years ago. I want to give you the floor for the 8 minutes before break, or I'll interrupt the whole time. I want you to really give us the state of the world. You've predicted this all very accurately in your books, in your articles. I want to talk about where we are right now financially. Then I want to look at your expert breakdown of the Clintons and the Bushes and the elections coming up here. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you very much for having me on, Alex. I'm going to start then with how our current big banking system culminated in the last, well, basically since the repeal of Glass-Steagall Act in 1999. But really, in the last 14 years, there has been immense consolidation at the hands, particularly of the big six banks in the United States. That's Goldman Sachs, Morgan Stanley, Bank of America, Citigroup, JP Morgan Chase, and Wells Fargo in two different stages. The first stage really relates to a little bit of what you were talking about before in terms of international security and those kinds of issues that you discussed, which was in the 2001-2002 period when the Enron scandal was breaking, when the WorldCom scandal was breaking, after banks had consolidated their first element of power in the wake of the Glass-Steagall Act being repealed under the Clinton administration in 1999 and enabling them, therefore, to become bigger and more concentrated and more in control of our capital worldwide. Those scandals were masked by ultimately 9/11 and what happened in Iraq. While that was going on, while attention was focused there, something else happened in the United States, which is that rates were cut. Banks started to accumulate more leverage, trade more riskily, and so forth in bigger fashion, enabled by government policy, enabled by the Federal Reserve policy. This went on until we saw the break in 2007, 2008 with the global financial crisis in which we are still consumed. As a result of that phase, right, the global financial crisis beginning on the back of these banks concentrating their capital at the hands of government and Federal Reserve policy, as well as global associated policy, we had this financial catastrophe. Since then, and this is important because it sets us up to what's happening in Greece and what's going on in Europe and globally. Since then, our big six banks, the ones that were at the pinnacle, at the crux, at the creation of the financial crisis, have grown, just the U.S. six banks, have grown in assets by 42%. They have grown in deposits, our deposits, by 86%. And their cash reserves, because of Federal Reserve and other zero interest rate and quantitative easing policy, are 400% larger. So they are in, despite that, a tremendously precarious position and want more. Because they have wanted more, and it's not just the big six banks in the United States, but they have really benefited the most from what's happened since the financial crisis globally in terms of their own concentration and power, and as I just mentioned, the assets, deposits, and the cash that they have. It's also a global phenomenon, of course, with the ECB and so forth. So what has been 7 years of enabling them to have zero interest rate cash, to accumulate their own reserves, to pretend that they are solvent, because that was supposedly why the Federal Reserve stepped in to give them this gift of liquidity and cheap money, which has really hurt everybody else. We get nothing on our savings accounts. We pay banks to hold our money. And now they're talking about ways to bail in or continue to hold our money if there is another phase of this crisis, which there will be. Now we turn over to what's happened since this accumulation has gone on in this phase to what's going on in Greece today. In 2008, Greece actually had the same debt to GDP ratio, which was around 100%, not great, but the same as what France has today. As what France, the sort of epicenter of core European power with Germany, has today. They had lower unemployment. They could manage their funds. They were actually okay. But in the wake of the 2008 crisis, when all banks around the world were looking to batten down the hatches and control capital and receive these benefits of low interest rate and buying of their bonds and creation of more debt to go through the banks to then be repurchased by the Fed in ECB and quantitative easing programs, places like Greece, which is the epicenter of obviously tragedy today, have had to deal with the fallout. So whereas today the blame, the sort of perception is that Greece couldn't manage its finances, that its pensioners are lazy, that its workers don't do anything. The reality is, in 2008, Greece was fine. and is part of the global financial crisis, the consolidation of control and capital and policies away from places like Greece, it bore the brunt of downgrades, of austerity programs, of the acquisition in return for bailout funds of their country. And as a result, their country weakened. Any country would. They were downgraded 6 times between 2010 and 2011 during this part of this crisis while they were given bailout money. While the terms of that bailout money from the Troika, from the ECB and IMF and so forth, were so heinous that all they did, and I looked at my website, actually. I wrote a piece on this to break in 2012. February 2012 said the Greek tragedy is just beginning. And it's on my thoughts page somewhere on my website. But the reality is it was beginning because it was the epicenter of this process of controlling a country's capital by forcing that country into not just austerity, but into depression. Now, there's lessons from the depression. Alex, this is really cool that you mentioned this in the beginning of your intro to me. I appreciate it. In the Great Depression, the first one in the 30s that was catalyzed by the big six banks in the United States in the 1929 crash, and people were trying to get their money out of banks because at the time there was no deposit insurance. And though banks were big and powerful and their leaders were associated with Washington and governments throughout the world, they didn't have anywhere near as much power as they have today, because at that point, the Federal Reserve was still in its infancy and it didn't stick along with the ECB, which didn't exist then. $7 trillion worth.
Naomi, we've got to go to break. Come back with this key point after we return. But I just want to point out, that's why we had you on. I remember having you on when you wrote that article 3 years ago. But even before that, predicting all of this. But here's the key. You just calmly dropped that bombshell, which is public information, but nobody's talking about it. They've now had banker bailouts worldwide with our tax money. The new model, that's not enough. They want to keep our money in the account and do a bail-in like Cyprus and steal our money publicly, doing what John Corzine only tried to do a few years ago at MF Global. I mean, this is unprecedented, and they're getting ready to do it here. You know, I actually had Naomi Prince come to Austin, Texas, and we've released some of the interview for the Obama Deception 2 that I got so busy I never completed. We are working on just releasing it to the public because it needs to be seen. And in those videos, it just clicked and I just remembered. She laid out everything and predicted what would happen in Greece is now happening and talked about how it's premeditated. And again, she worked at the highest levels inside these organizations. But regardless of whether it's premeditated or not, we know it is. The same effect. They're too big to fail. They create the derivatives. We bail out the banks. Then our nation states go into default because we bailed them out. That's the biggest part of it. And we're being maneuvered towards a global collapse, which will give them even more power. 2008 was just the global positioning for this. And now the installation of world leaders under banker technocratic control. Their words, not mine. And the arrogance of the EU, same as the American Union or TPP, same people, threatening Greece, you better not have a referendum. Naomi Prinz joins us, who's managing director at Goldman Sachs, new book, All the President's Bankers. This is a short segment, long segment coming up, but you got cut off going through a parallel of the same big 5-6 mega banks in the Depression who head up the private Federal Reserve. That's their government, quasi-government consortium, for those that don't know. Running the same playbook now, but on a global scale. But back then, the U.S. wasn't tied under an International Bank of Settlements. So I love watching International Bank of Settlements a few days ago go, oh, a global meltdown's coming. It's terrible. The Federal Reserve and other central banks did a bad job when they represent these people. I mean, I love watching them tattle on themselves, playing on the public's financial illiteracy.
Yeah, no, that's an amazing. Their 85th annual report, the Bank of International Settlements, which ties into that depression period. So again, those big six banks, the Federal Reserve in its infancy, our government at the time, crash in 1929 happens. People can't get their money. So basically, at the end of that, people try to get their money. We get deposit insurance. We get a Glass-Steagall Act passed. We have some control over the division of our deposits, our money, from the risky transactions and consolidation of the bigger banks. And it worked for a number of decades. But that started to dissipate in the 70s, 80s, and so forth. That's when bail-in economics started. And what bail-in economics which is a combination of the private banks and leading these institutions, as you mentioned, as well as the governments, as well as these central bank institutions and the BIS and the IMF and so forth.
They now use the bailout as a way to put themselves into it, hold us hostage to them through the FDIC and similar systems.
Well, exactly. And actually, that was one of FDR's main concerns at the time. Put in the FDIC because people were scared. He wanted banks to be able to have people's money protected. Otherwise, they wouldn't put money in the bank. So in a way, it was helping the banks. On the other hand, he was concerned that this could happen because now our money is kind of hostage. Well, it is actually hostage to this greater leverage and these greater plans, and it has become that. So when you see now what's going on in Greece, where they had to, they had no choice but to install capital controls. That is reminiscent of the pre-Great Depression Glass-Steagall days, when people were trying to get money out of banks and they had no recourse at the time. And when banks went under, their money was just simply gone.
And now we see that happening in Greece. Clearly, we see the preparations being made for this all over the West. Can you speak to that and what you think that signifies?
Well, what it signifies, Greece is in this position where it's defending itself against these egregious bailout terms that were put upon it to begin with as a result of capital, you know, killing them and then coming out in the 2008 period in the financial crisis. So, you know, the big banks, these institutions, they wanted money from Greece. They wanted Greece, and now they have Greece in a chokehold, and Greece is trying to do anything it can to protect itself. In the Great Depression, what Greece did was it left its tie to the British pound when the British pound devalued. It floated the drachma. It sorted out its own economics, and it actually flourished relative to the rest of Europe before a lot of the Great Depression was over relative to other countries. So, I mean, it had the mechanism before. But the point of the balance, the point of going after cash is bigger, because what can now happen is large banks, forget the small ones in Greece, but large banks like Citigroup can go to, well, they are part of, go to the Federal Reserve, talk to the government, say, you know what, we need to have mechanisms to control cash right now in case something like this.
Oh, as you know, I covered it 2 weeks ago. They're now, speaking of Citi, when you show that headline, saying we need to control the cash to decide where it's spent and when. Just bizarre totalitarian statements nakedly in the opening showing their trial ballooning.
Right. And rather than, you know, looking at Greece as something that requires leadership and fixing and you know, the fact that these bailout terms were egregious and austerity was to begin with, they're using it and they will use it. They will use it as an example of why these cash control mechanisms should be infused, because the reality is they are not solvent after 7 years of zero interest rate policy, liquidity infusions from the central banks, a $7 trillion book between the ECB and the Federal Reserve supporting the private banking system and these big banks. Even with that, even with 400% more cash than they had before, even with less loans to people.
Naomi, stay there. I'm going to give you the floor when we come back to roll with this. I don't want to get into politics and how they're maneuvering their people in like a Don King boxing match where they win either way. Stay with us. I'm Alex Jones, Infowars.com. They want you to be scared of things that really are non-existent out there, boogeymen. But don't be scared of the globalists taking your country over. I want Naomi Prince to finish up a point that got cut off by the break. Talk about where all this is going and talk about the mindset of these people, because we had Joseph Stiglitz on 2002, 2006. We've had him on 5-6 times. Two-time Nobel Prize winner, former head of economics, economics, head economist at the World Bank. And he basically admitted here this is a planned takeover and that it's very immoral. He didn't want to be part of it. He left in 2002. Naomi left Goldman Sachs around the same time. So there was already corruption and problems and greed in global banking, but it got really draconian around 2002, according to Greg Palast and other investigative journalists. It really started getting bad. And it's bipartisan across the world, or tripartisan, or quadpartisan in like Germany, where there are 4 major parties, 3 major parties in England, 2 here. And they just buy you off. We've had hundreds of senior bankers killed, Arkansas-ed. And all of this is building towards a head. We're going to go back to our guest here in a moment. Her new book, All the Presidents, Bankers, the Hidden Alliances That Drive American Power. I remember mainline Republican-oid talk show host 15 years ago saying I was a kook and a liar and that there didn't even exist a Council on Foreign Relations and that there were no global banks and global government. Now it's all pretty much out in the open. But they first created a politically correct stigma towards criticizing it. that stigma's kind of over. In fact, you guys have the famous, there's a bunch of these clips, but the MSNBC where it's like 5 minutes long and all five of the pundits and the guest host all agree that aren't we just slaves to central bankers? And then they admit it. We'll cue that up. So this is the big enchilada. And they don't want to fix things because every crisis that comes, they get more power. We're going to go back to Nomi in a moment, but get her book, read it, give it to friends and family. Pretty soon it'll be a conspiracy theory that people ever even read, or that women gave birth vaginally or breastfed. I mean, or that seeds weren't GMO. I mean, I'm not joking. This is a hardcore scientific takeover. But before we go any further, in the entire month of July, and I've decided to launch it a day early, we've never done this for a whole month, free shipping on everything that we ship. That's 90%+ of the products. A few of the products are drop shipped, like shortwave radios and some of the water filters. But everything else is absolutely in-house. The high-quality non-GMO seeds, the lowest prices, the great nutraceuticals like X-Tube, even though that's selling out, the colloidal silver, the super male, super female vitality, the lung cleanse, all of it is available with free shipping. And a lot of these products, like the Made in America apparel, there's a bunch of t-shirt specials, a bunch of Molon Labe belt buckle specials, 25% off on top of free shipping. So that applies on top of all the other specials. I just keep doubling down on the free market activities, and it's been successful. Less profit per capita item, very competitive, plus you're supporting hardcore liberty and the truth. It's a win-win buying war bonds in the info war. They've still got 20% off going on the water filters. They've still got 25% off going on the Molon Labe, Made in America products. I mean, it's all there. InfoWarsLife.com, InfoWarsStore.com, or 888-253-3139. And I guess I was wrong. I've been told there is free shipping on the water filters as well. I thought it wasn't being extended to stuff that's drop shipped, but it is. So InfoWarsStore.com or 888-253-3139. There are so many specials on the site right now, and your purchase makes the TV show, the radio shows, the nightly news, the films, the books, the special reports, everything we do that is hitting political pay dirt. Unifying the left and right, transcending the diversions, the balkanization, exposing the globalists, exposing their paradigm. This is huge. Getting people outside the matrix. We're building towards that V for Vendetta moment, but not an explosive, violent moment, but a revelation. I was thinking about, then we'll go into our guest, doing a piece like how ranch dressing could save the world. And that's the kind of thing that'll wake up the sheeple. They'll see a headline like that. I'm sure somebody else will do this now. That's fine. And then the sheeple will click on that, and I'll say, that's right. No one knows when people in the 80s started putting ranch dressing on pepperoni pizza mainly. But now most major chains and most restaurants offer it because it's popular. No one knows who started it, but it started with one person. And now it's ubiquitous all over the world, not just here. You go, well, why does that matter? It doesn't. But I've talked to top NSA insiders on air and off air. We've had William Benny, the former technical director, right here of 2 feet from me sitting here. I had James Bamford on. I had just countless whistleblowers on 20 years ago. I did not engage in espionage against the criminal globalist. I was approached at movie theaters where I did showings a few times and at the rodeo by people claiming they had worked with the NSA. And they would explain to me, just like in a V for Vendetta moment where the cops being talked to by V at the park, and they told me, it's about stealing other countries' data and giving it to the globalists to build in China. It's about destroying the free market. It's about if strawberries are trending, I was actually told this as an example, getting ahead of the trend and being able to dominate it. It's about shutting down trends that threaten the globalists or disruptive technology to their takeover. And I kind of knew that, but here they were telling me. And just Scientific Atlantic cable boxes are listening to you. Break one open on air, and I did, and it was there. And just on and on and on. The TVs already have microphones in them. Boom, they were. Now it's all admitted. And I'm talking about in the parking lot, three-minute conversations twice. And like, here's the technicals of the Time Warner system wired into the NSA. And I called my dad, and he goes, throw it away. Throw it in a trash can. Don't even look at it, because it was true. I mean, they arrest you for that, folks. I don't even know if it was a setup. But the point is, that that's the world where I live, okay? And now it's all come out. And this is a total takeover. And a lot of people have gone through hell to bring you this information. And now it's all coming out in the open because they're going to launch their final phases of the takeover. Now, I've been ranting. You got the floor for the 10 minutes left in this segment and 6 minutes of the next. Nomi Prinz, all the president's bankers, NomiPrinz.com. We should republish an InfoWars, your article from 3 years ago predicting the whole Greece situation. In fact, I'm going to do that now and put a link to your site at the bottom of it. But we've got interviews with you, not just on radio, but here in studio, talking about, I'm going to put that out in the next few days. It just reminded me. But Nomi, you've heard my rant here about where we stand. Do you think I'm wrong that they're lined up for their next big takeover, their next big phase? They have the Pope calling for global government. I mean, it's getting really obvious now. Private central banks are going to implode the world economy and offer a new global SDR digital currency that pegs all the other currencies, and they're getting ready for the final crisis to bring in their total takeover, or is there another crisis after that? Go ahead.
Yeah, I was just listening to you, Alex, and that when you said final crisis, I'm not quite sure if there is a final one. I think, you know, as you capped off there could be a series of crises. But yes, what has happened, and this has been decades in the building, but more accelerated since the financial crisis 2008, because that was just the most recent inflection point of the most epic and unprecedented, even with the BIS, the Bank of International Settlements, the central bank of the central bank saying so at this point, of subsidization, because that's the first step in control. It's always the first step in control financially of the private banking / central banking system.
They got to get us on the hook for their crimes.
Well, exactly. And this is what's been happening. So, you know, I'll tell you, it goes back to, well, it goes back a lot of ways. But in the 80s, you know, we talk about Reagan's Treasury Secretary was the CEO of Merrill Lynch back then, the first CEO from a major U.S. bank that was in that position. He was friends with George H.W. Bush. They got together, deregulated part of the industry to allow it to consolidate its power and its capital. As a byproduct of that, this was around the time of the Latin American debt crisis. That was kind of like the current Greece and European and global crisis that we're having today, which is that the private banks did a lot of tricky dealings, lavished a lot of debt, which was sort of cover for all sorts of other extractions of private assets and other ways of sort of transporting what was in some of these countries into their context, into their asset base. And when that failed, when it went belly up, when those countries couldn't sustain the bad terms of the debt that they had, these countries came, these banks, I'm sorry, they are countries, they're larger than countries. These banks came to the United States government and said, we need a bailout. And under Reagan, under Bush, under Brady, under all these people starting in the 80s and then working in through the Clinton administration in the 90s, the Bush and Obama administrations more recently, they continued to receive banking subsidies, liquidity subsidies, capital, the purchasing of their crappy toxic assets, the ongoing aid to them for the risk they took with our money in greater and greater ways. So the 2008 component of this particular phase of financial crisis and consolidation of control and capital, because it is about power and money together, those two things are not distinct, is setting us up for the next phase. And as I started to say before, and we talked about it a little bit, is the money aspect is the only thing that hasn't really been touched in this particular phase. Banks have had subsidies. They've had liquidity injections. The central banks for a minute said, this is great. Look, they're so well capitalized. We put in all these new rules. The next time there's a crisis, they're going to be fine. But everyone knows at that level, those elite levels, they are not fine. And one of the ways we know publicly on our side of the equation that they are not fine is because they also want cash. And as I started to say before, the Greek situation now putting in capital controls to defend itself from the extraction, from these policies of taking smaller countries' assets, diluting them and accumulating them outside into the larger, more elite countries and governments and powerful banks is something that's going to continue. And so it's a political aspect, it is a power aspect, it's a private banking aspect, and it is a central banking aspect altogether. And it's happening now in an unprecedented way. Because instead of after the 2008 crisis of defusing this power, all of these bodies came together to basically concentrate that power. And that's why, in particular in the United States, and this is really important, in particular, the United States banks have concentrated more of their power, both politically as well as from a concentration of capital standpoint, relative to Europe. So whereas before the 2008 crisis, there was a sort of mix between the European banks going nuts with the bets that they were taking and the leverage they were taking and the problems that they were incurring on the local economies with not lending to them, but instead saving the capital they were getting from their central bank, from the ECB, to solidify themselves and make all of those rulers feel happy and content because it was free money to them, the United States banking system has been the biggest recipient of this global policy to date. So whereas initially, going back a couple of wars, the end of World War I, the end of World War II, the United States always became a greater superpower because of its control over bank capital, because of the policies that different entities could aggregate together and ensue upon the general financial system. After World War II, of course, we got the IMF, we got the World Bank. Those were mechanisms of deciding which countries would receive aid and which countries would receive real aid. And real aid was cheap money.
The beginning of a banking-based global government. And now what do you see this new consolidation doing? Because it looks like this big next epic phase, not the final phase, but for all intents and purposes, the launch of global corporate government openly. Let me ask you this question. What does it do to America and Europe? Because it appears in the past they ate Latin America, Africa, areas of Asia, and the third world and old world. Now, as the World Bank document showed in 2002, they want to fully consolidate power here and have us bail them out yet again, then making us their slaves in the process. True alchemy. My point is, a lot of people think America being behind the global empire is good, but doesn't the average person just fit the bill?
Well, we as Americans, by being at the bottom of that equation, you know, so when the U.S. banking system, the political system, the Federal Reserve instill these policies across the world and sort of control it. I mean, it was our Treasury Department, United States Treasury Department, United States Federal Reserve that incurred these policies throughout the world. It was Tim Geithner and who went over to Europe and said, and Jack Lew afterwards, you know, you guys have to do these same policies. You have to continue them. We need zero interest rate. We need you to buy bonds. We need you to infiltrate your policies, which are our policies on a global basis. That is control. I mean, that is the United States controlling the equation. And in the wake of the financial crisis of 2008, we have become more in control over most of the global financial alchemy, as you mentioned it. Where we don't have the same control is over sort of the Russian and China, the aspects that are trying to independently create their own trading systems, their own currency, their own development banks. But those are still small. They're still small relative to what's happening on the U.S.-European basis, where the U.S. Is really controlling the shots, because we had the first subsidy program for our private banks. Our banks became bigger relative to European banks after the financial crisis. Our Fed has $4.5 trillion of assets on its balance sheet, among all sorts of other plays to prop up this global financial system, as per coming from the United States elements, versus a $2.5 trillion that's being accumulated at the ECB, and it will probably grow to $3 trillion. So what's happening is all of these subsidies are continuing to grow. All of the central banks led by the United States are continuing to take signals from the United States and the U.S. government. And whether it is an Obama administration, whether it is a Hillary Clinton administration, whether it is a Jeb Bush administration, will continue on this play. And this play will continue to consolidate capital and power at the hands of these individuals who have the most legacy connections, historical relationships, and similar ideologies from a globalist perspective as the U.S. banks have.
All right, stay there. I want to come back and get into your article that was in New York Daily News, Hillary Clinton, Jeb Bush, and the big banks. It's also at NomiPrinz.com. And look at how these two horses, or these two fighters, might as well be in a rigged Don King boxing match. And who do you think the anointed one will be? Or will they let us choose from two of their minions who will follow orders? Nomi Prinz, former managing director of Goldman Sachs, is our guest. In the third hour, we're going to cover the waterfront. Stay with us. Well, a civil rights icon, and we'll cover this the next hour, has come out and said the problem is blacks killing other blacks, not the Confederate flag. New knockout game, nearly 50 black teens raid Walmart, attack shop, or destroy merchandise. ISIS burns CIA opium fields in Afghanistan. They're going to get in trouble for that. They're now in Afghanistan. Social justice Twitterers referred to periods as women's issues is transphobic. So there you go. All language is now racist or sexist. And I'm going to play the clips in the next hour. Three top comics say that political correctness is killing comedy. This isn't the left. This is just pop left. The real left that cares about people, you know, is against GMO and against banks raping us, but so is the Tea Party. Notice how it was the Tea Party and a bunch of Democrats that were against TPP. In fact, if Naomi Prince could do 5 minutes the next hour, I want to ask her about TPP. Her new book, All the President's Bankers, The Hidden Alliances That Drive American Power. I haven't gotten the video of maniac cops straps handcuffed man to a chair and tortures him. We'll cover that coming up the next hour. But first, I'm going to cover disturbing new reports on the degeneration of the Western brain. Physically, this isn't just culture. What's happening? Investigative report live. We're going to break it down coming up. Naomi, there's a quote on Infowars.com, and it's, if you don't want a man unhappy politically, don't give him two sides to a question to worry him. Give him one. Better yet, give him none. Ray Bradbury, famous author. Well, you know, that's true. But you want the illusion of choice, and that's what Carol Quigley wrote about at Georgetown in his secret CIA State Department published book that ended up going public, Tragedy and Hope, where he admitted, we already own both parties, we will more so in the future, there will be the illusion of choice, we'll have diversionary political battles, gay marriage, Confederate flags, while we take over and move us into a totalitarian system. I mean, these are admitted totalitarians. We've got 3-4 minutes to break, but break down your excellent article that goes over this, Hillary Clinton, Jeb Bush, and the big banks.
All right, so the whole idea of totalitarian power is about controlling money, policy, power. I mean, it's all part of the same equation. So if we look at Hillary and Jeb, they're just two examples of two dynasties that have gotten this right from their perspective, not necessarily from our perspective. And as you mentioned, this isn't a left-right thing. It doesn't actually matter because both of them are examples of decades-long relationships, associations, similar ideologies with the largest banks. You look at Hillary Clinton, you find, you know, you find Citigroup because of the Robert Rubin connection, which also gets you to Goldman Sachs because of the Robert Rubin connection, who was the Treasury Secretary of Bill Clinton, who helped get Bill Clinton into office, who helped Wall Street galvanize between the initial Clinton bid for power and the White House and were very successful. They have all stayed friends. Hillary has spoken there. Bill Clinton, of course, as we know through the Clinton Foundation, was getting lots of money for speeches elsewhere while she was both Secretary of State and later speaking at Goldman and other banking conventions. So that connection, those relationships, they stay in place. That money, that power, that stays in place. The same token, you know, Jeb Bush, I mentioned before the Merrill Lynch connection, because back in the day it was Father Bush and the former CEO of Merrill Lynch, which is now part of Bank America, one of the big sixes, who were part of the policy that deregulated the banking system, which when that happens, it allows the larger players in the banking system to have more money and power. So the governments in place that helped to deregulate the banks both get collaborative power from that equation.
Naomi, we've got to go to break, and I'll give you the next 5 minutes if you can stay with us for a 70-second break. But I'm putting on screen for TV viewers an article out of the Daily Mail, Piles of Diamonds and Porn, Concord and Caviar, Haunting Images of Crumbling Palaces of Africa's Dictators, where despots once lived like emperors. The only difference between these guys and North Korea and Kim Jong-un is they don't wear crowns. Same thing with the Goldman Sachs and J.P. Morgans. They've stolen literally thousands of times what these African dictators did. They're just smart and don't really consume so conspicuously. But this is the opposite of free market. We'll be back in 70 seconds with our guests to talk about that and where this is all going in the predator economy. All right, now let's go to Naomi Prince. Here's my three questions in the 5 minutes we have left, and I really appreciate your time and energy and your struggle and giving up your career, very successful, to expose the corruption and not going with the herd. We see Puerto Rico saying they're ready to go bankrupt like Greece. We know that most counties and cities and states are worse off than Greece here in the U.S. If you look at the numbers. We're signing on to the TPP. Obama's been given Republican power to be a dictator. Got to give the Democrats credit for being against that. It's true. As bad as Obama is, the Republican leadership is just as bad or worse. We're in so much trouble. Where is this all going?
Yeah, I mean, it's going to another phase of the crisis that we're currently in. All of what you mentioned is this movement of money and power away from, well, into the hands of those that already have it. It continues to be a consolidation. So if you look at Puerto Rico, you look at Greece, you look at states, you look at municipalities, these are all entities that never had or hadn't had the power to begin with going into this latest phase of the financial crisis, which gave the people at the top, the elite bankers and politicians and central bankers, the ability to take more in this period of time.
Are they the new royalty?
They are the new royalty. I mean, I consider, you know, the Bushes and the Clintons the same type of a monarchy as, I mean, actually more dangerous monarchy than, you know, anybody sort of, you know, than the Queen of England. Why? Because they control our capital. You know, all the old leaders and even what they were associated with over the centuries of monarchies did not control to the same extent the future capital because they didn't have the leverage. They didn't have the ability to fictitiously create money and then spread it into the most powerful financial private bodies in order for them to continue to amass control and concentrate their power over us. We had fewer banks now than we had then. We have more concentrated capital and power, therefore, than we had then. So yes, it's a form of a monarchy. It's a form of a totalitarian government, but it's also something that's continuing. So, I mean, as I said a few years ago about Greece, as I said, you know, 12 years ago about what was going to happen in the financial sector, how that was going to implode and reconcentrate, because that is what happens. Every time something negative happens financially in the world, the people in power use it, leverage it as a way to concentrate power.
This is Will they get away this time with even a bigger power grab and bailout and grabbing our cash? How will the government spend that? I guess with some form of civil emergency or launch a war to get us to support the government?
Well, honestly, it depends on how much we are willing to take it because, well, not necessarily, but what it looks like will happen to be by how much we take it. Our cash, our money, those trillions and trillions of dollars of deposits are the only thing on our side of the equation right now relative to the $7 trillion from the two major central banks, to all the policies, to all the concentration of power, all those meetings in Basel, to everything that happens. We are the only counteraction right now.
Sure.
And so, yes, that is why our money is at risk, because there's nothing else to take. There's no other plan. So this is the plan. It's not a conspiracy. There's no other way.
That's right.
To continue to make it work.
We have a banking dictatorship, no better, in fact, worse, because it's more sophisticated, than North Korea's dynasty, than African dictatorships. We now have absolute criminals in control, bipartisan, and it's time to wake up and realize they're illegitimate because they want to wreck us for full control. That's why Africa and Latin America are so poor. Their elites like to keep you poor.
Ours are bigger.
So you agree with that statement. In 60 seconds, Nomi Prinz, NomiPrinz.com, how do we stop them? What do we do?
Well, again, we have the power of our own money. We have the power of our own vote. We have the power of our own voice. And that's really the only thing we can do. We have the power of the truth behind us. It's really hard. This gets to be a harder fight every single day because we are on the losing side of a capital and power grab that has policy behind it, that has those institutions behind it that we are not. But we do have ourselves, and we do have our collective voices, our collective cash, our collective way of not keeping it in the biggest banks and putting it in smallest banks, our ability to take it out of the market rather than be the backside of what is going on in terms of this accumulation of capital and power. And so that is something that we have to be aware of. We have to understand it's a truth. It's not a myth. It's actually happening. And we have to take control of our own cash, our own voices, our own assets.
That's right. They want to take the cash because we can still vote for with our dollars, with our euros, and change things. It's the only power we have left that isn't a shooting war. We salute you, Nomi Prinz. You're an amazing patriot for humanity. Thank you so much. I'm not name dropping. I'm just proud of the fact that I knew Charlton Heston, interviewed him twice, and talked to him a few times lengthy on the phone. Not bragging. I just love Charlton Heston. It's hard for me to play that promo about how Soylent Green's becoming reality and see Charlton Heston, and just, I celebrate humanity, great poets, great actors, great scientists, but I admire Charlton Heston more because even though he was demonized and attacked, he spent over $10 million of his own money. That's not really known, that's known by inside baseball people. $10 million of his own money in that last decade or so, flying around on a private jet, giving speeches for the Second Amendment. He wasn't paid by the NRA. And by the way, $10 million, even though he was been a huge actor, back then you got paid maybe $500,000 for starring in a movie. He spent most of his money. That's why his wife talked trash about him and stuff once he was senile and rolled him out on TV where he, I'm sorry, honey. Then a week later they announced he's totally doesn't even know who he is. Talk about traitorous. Roll him out once he doesn't know who he is to have him denounce everything he stood for. I think it was NBC. I remember watching that interview going, that's not Charlton Heston. God almighty, these people are sick. I just admire Charlton Heston because he was such an honorable person and spent basically his whole fortune to fight for the Second Amendment. And he was a civil rights activist before it was cool in Oklahoma and Alabama. That's why they called him racist on TV. See, if you get awards from Hitler, you get put on the cover of Time Magazine as a great person, Margaret Sanger. Or if you openly say you want to be like Hitler and kill all the blacks and people, then you get ADL awards because you're Arnold Schwarzenegger. We fight proto-Nazism, eugenics, that is the dominant global ideology. We are called racist with no proof by MSNBC, ADL, Southern Poverty Law Center. Because they are scum. They are traitors to humanity. They are filth. I saw an article, I meant to cover it last week, I forget, was it in Raw Story or Salon, I forget where, and it was like, Alex Jones is a fearmonger, he has alarm ads on his show for wireless alarms they say are more effective on a cell phone-based system. That's been out for 15 years. All the alarm companies sell that, but for like $500, the sponsor of the network has, it's not even mine, I wish we had them. It's simply safe or whatever is like a fraction of that. It's just a cell phone system that calls the police. When you see alarm ads on every major channel, when they do, it's okay. But when we sell alarms, it's bad for a lower price. Well, I don't know why I just digressed off into that, but I'm not ashamed of selling things. And yes, I'm going to tell you why I'm selling something right now. We're funding our operation with hardcore things we use. And I'm not even going to get into the news first. At the bottom of the hour, I'm going to play the videos of cops going crazy, not to demonize police and play into a revolution against police, which is a plan to bring down the country, but to understand why the globalists have changed the hiring process through federal guidelines to produce these type of monsters to then set up departments. We don't expose bad police to demonize all the police. We do it to reform the police and give good police and good people locally a chance to reform themselves. That's what we do. And that's why the police listen to us and actually check out what we're saying. If we just attack them, they're not going to listen. They get driven into the globalist arms. This is all divide and conquer, folks. So we're going to break that down. We're going to get into the CIA former director saying brace for terror attacks over July 4th from ISIS. And who could have thought? Well, we told you exactly this was all coming. And it's not like Al-Qaeda that was synthetic before. There's 200,000 plus ISIS folks. They're being allowed to recruit and travel around. And they're going to be used to take our freedoms. And I know you're like, yeah, you've been saying this every day. Yeah, for about 4 or 5 years, back when they were Al-Qaeda. Same group. So that's coming up. Bottom of the hour, Gucciardi will ride shotgun with us. Anthony Gucciardi, a writer here at Infowars.com, researcher, of course, founded Natural Society and StoryLeak. Natural Society, it's in the top five natural health sites out there. Really honored to have him working with us the last few years. Look at these headlines. Top predator, humans causing catastrophic ecosystem shifts, new study shows, Reuters. They had the study 2 weeks ago by Paul Ehrlich, who they don't tell you is an open eugenicist, and wrote a book with the White House science czar about fluorides in the water to brain damage you and lower fertility. His words, not mine. About how the sixth great extinction is coming and how humans need to be basically taken out. Well, they are taking us out. Sugar makes you stupid. Men's Fitness. Can sugar make you stupid? High concern in wake of rat study. Our attention span is now less than that of a goldfish, Microsoft study shows. You now have a shorter attention span than a goldfish. This is some of the researchers say Western IQ has dropped 14 points in the last century. Yahoo News. This is just some of the news. You can look at screen time, brain damaging children, neurological disorders connected to television. It's all designed. The general public, we can laugh at them, but they're in a trance state. Being told Confederate flag, gay marriage, tranny, racist, brown bag bad. While global government comes in, and while their food and water supply is jacked. Now they've got the public so stunned, you can pull up Fox News going, mercury's good for you, CBS, mercury's good for your baby. Or Fox News, should lithium be added and help the public? To the water. Should statins be added? This is what's happening, ladies and gentlemen. I mean, this is crazy. The good news is, though, almost every scientist at the FDA in the last decade, not once, not twice, but three times, has sent unanimous, nearly unanimous letters to their director saying, take fluoride out. It's causing massive brain damage, massive cancer. Here's the Harvard study. Here's the Chinese study. Here's the UT study. Here's the, you know, Venezuelan study. Here's the, here's all, I mean, it's there. So here's the deal. You can't perfect, and we're going to skip this network break. This is so important. We can't reverse all of this completely, but I had just given into the soft kill attack 20 years ago. I thought they'd kill me any moment. So many death threats. I got to where I quit working out, turned into this giant blob. I'm not pushing Super Male Vitality right now, folks, or X2, but just missing the good halogen when the bad halogens were filling my glands. After 2 weeks on it, I went through a detox, and then it felt like when I'd been carrying one of my 2 or 3 year olds up a big hill, like Mount Bonnell, you know, up a couple hundred flights of stairs, whatever. Not a couple hundred flights, hundreds of steps. When you take them off your shoulders, you feel like you're flying. That's what almost everybody says they feel like after 2 weeks to a month on it. Well, I talked to the guy who's been doing our air conditioning for 5 years. He, nice guy, I hardly ever talk to him. He comes over and he goes, can I talk to you? And I was looking at him, well, man, I hardly recognize this guy. He wasn't fat. He was in good shape, but looks like he's lost 15 pounds. His face looks all chiseled. And then out of his mouth comes, I did the cleanse. And we're sold out of it, by the way. I'm not pitching liver shield. We still have the oxy powder that works great as well, but with it, it just flushes out your gallbladder. And so we come on air, and he said, maybe I'm kind of shy, but he said, it's the swelling, the inflammation in my body. And I lost, like, I think he said 14 pounds in a week. He said he was into day 9. He's going ahead and just still doing the liver shield every day. And he looked like a different person. He looked 10 years younger. I'm not exaggerating. And I told you this morning, try to see if we can twist his arm. Leanne's friend, she wants to come on, contacted us, wants to talk about what it did for her. She's real healthy, and she's done other cleanses. She says this one blows it away. By the way, that's sold out. The point is, this is real life-changing stuff. It doesn't mean I'm a beach boy right now after 15 years of killing myself, but I've lost 60-plus pounds. I've super muscular with my shirt off. If people seen photos before and after, just in 30-something days doing the last cleanse 6 months ago. I never ended up doing the cleanse a few weeks ago. I did it for 2 days and quit. I'm going to do it again next Monday. But, and then do the before and after photos. I even forgot to do that. This is such an epic time to be alive. We can physically come in and do things that aren't in our diets, that aren't in the, I mean, look, longevity, InfoWarsHealth.com. They're beyond tangy tangerine, 2.0, totally organic. That's a huge game changer and helped me as well. It's a lot of things. We don't have the minerals we need. But we've launched something here that doesn't, well, it affects the whole body, but it doesn't target the liver, it doesn't target the heart, it doesn't target the kidneys, doesn't target the skin, even though it does. Where you really feel it, though, is in the brain. And I can't wait to hear the reviews for this because I've already seen them in the office. We've had Brain Force in for 3 months with different formulas we worked on, with the final formula that we have one of the biggest manufacturers in the country, highest quality, totally organic, and they said to us, this is insane. The other leading competitors cost $10 more. $10 more. $10 more. And have ingredients that aren't as good and aren't as strong. This is undoubtedly better than formulas, $100, $200 for $29.95. It is a total game changer. Everybody's just too lazy, too stupid, too greedy to do what we're doing. We're just vicious free market, vicious innovators, vicious, vicious, vicious. Total Americana, Brain Force is here. Ladies and gentlemen, I've been on this the last few months. You probably noticed I've been more crazed, more focused, less brain fog, more energy, more special reports, and it's because of Brain Force. Now, we have a limited first-time run. I told you that with the last four products. They're all sold out, some of them for 8 weeks. Liver Shield, all of it, it's gone. Okay, and that's because the foodies and the healthies go and research us, go to third-party sites, read the reviews, and discover we're putting out sick nutraceutical stuff better than what you get at doctor's offices. You go to doctor's offices now, and I go to a great one to check my blood and everything now. I'm getting older. I wanted to, you know, get in shape, everything checked out. They sell stuff similar to this, but you got to get a prescription for it just because it's from a prescription system because they changed some of the enzymes and things. They just tweak it so they can say it's prescription. People want that. This, ladies and gentlemen, BrainForce, is the most insane booster ever. And it doesn't have stimulants. It doesn't have garbage in it. It has natural things that do it clean. I mean, what's that movie? I meant to plug it. Limitless. Yeah, Limitless, where he takes that and then, I mean, it's not like that, but it's the closest thing that I've ever experienced, and it's what God gave us, the big pharmacist in the sky. Andy Gucciardi, I've been ranting. BrainForce, a limited supply, a very limited run of this is in. And when I heard you guys had ordered this small amount, I just said, you know what, I got a feeling this is going to be hot. Double the next order. So this took us months to get in. 2 weeks ago, we put in the new order. So when this sells out, it'll be a month and a half till we get more. So if you want your BrainForce, get it now. Anthony, and then we're going to go into what's happened to the brain and the science of this in this special report. But this is just an example of what these compounds can do for you. And I challenge you to try this formula or to go try one of the ingredients in it separately in the store. You'll be paying the same amount for one ingredient in the store when this is a fusion. Anthony Gucciardi, we formulated this with some of the top formulators in the country. Describe what they said to us when we did this.
That's right. And remember, a couple months ago, I was speaking to one of the chemists, the top chemist in the United States for nutraceutical formulation on the East Coast.
We're not joking.
This is the real deal. And he's used to people coming to him and saying, hey, look, I want a pretty decent formula, but I don't want to pay that much for it. I want to cut corners. I want to make something that's okay.
A dollar a bottle.
Right. A dollar a bottle, sometimes 70 cents, sometimes 50 cents.
Top names.
Right. These are huge companies we won't talk about. I've been told how they sweep herbs on the floor with brooms and pick them back up and put them in the conveyor belts. I mean, it's
straight really, from China.
Really, really bizarre. So anyway, we come in, we say, no, we actually want the real deal. We want what's comparable to the formulas that are $100 and $200, but we want to make it affordable, right? So this guy says, okay, I'll look into it. We kept changing this formula over and over and over again until it became sort of a grand puzzle. For example, the L-theanine inside of it, that is activated by the different compounds in the yerba mate that we put inside of it as well. And all together, we put all these 10 different ingredients. You could buy each one of these for about $20 each. We put 10 different ingredients. We put it into a $30 bottle. And he told me point blank, he said, look, this might be the best formula I've ever made. You should probably order some more. And we said, oh, whatever. You know, it's a pretty cool formula. Then I took the experimental version of it with the graphic designer as well here at the InfoWars Studios. I popped two pills and I was sitting there for about 5 minutes, drank some water, and I started to feel this really warm energy. And you said it best to me earlier. You said it doesn't give you like an energy spike, like an energy drink.
Yeah, I can't take bad one. I can't take the 5 hour stuff and I can't take the Red Bull because it gives me a dirty energy.
Right, right. So that's like a dirty synthetic energy. This, we want organic based compounds. So when you take it, for me, I feel sort of tingling in my scalp. And that's when I know it's working and I get energy. I get real, what I would call like warm, natural energy, as opposed to like a spike, like a freak out spike when you drink too much energy drinks. So to me, this is a consistent and sustainable. And you were kind of telling me also, one of the worst things with most energy products is it's not sustainable, right? You're going to crash afterwards. And the cool thing about this is it's not just a bunch of energy compounds that are going to fire your brain up to a higher RPM or whatever, which it does do. This is sustainable. This isn't going to spike and you're going to collapse and you're going to feel really bad afterwards. This has a bunch of different antioxidants and compounds and polyphenols.
And I've been taking it with the X2, which I'm taking right now in my water. I forgot to take it this morning. And I then take it. I only take one of the pills a day because I can't handle it. I mean, but the thing is, again, I've taken natural herbal stuff a few times to test it out. We were thinking about selling. And when I was approached before I even put it out on my shelf by third parties years ago, and it would get me going, but then I'd feel horrible the next day. This doesn't do that.
Yeah, exactly. And if we want to get into the science of it, I have a hole in the stack, too, that I didn't get a chance to bring in. But basically, one of these compounds, and it's amazing we're able to bring this to you, it's alpha-GPC, one of the main compounds in BrainForce, is actually a pharmaceutical drug in Europe. You cannot get it without a prescription. That's how powerful it is. They use it for cognitive health. So let's say you go into a doctor. I'm not going to get too specific.
We've got it on screen from the encyclopedia, alpha-GPC.
You can't
tell folks what that is. We got plenty of time.
You can't get this in Europe without a prescription. One of the 10 ingredients in BrainForce is actually a prescription drug. And, of course, the United States, the FDA, doesn't actually have that much interest in taking the natural compounds unless the big pharma corporations can make money on it. And that's why it costs about $12 million per prescription.
Oh, let's be clear. They're trying to move to ban all this.
Oh, of course. And theazine Actually, let's talk about L-theanine again. So L-theanine is one of the main compounds of green tea. And that's what's so interesting to me is that it, like I said, it's activated from the other ingredients inside of it. So a lot of people say, well, I take L-theanine and I spend 30, 40 bucks on the super high quality form of it. And I feel okay. I get a little energy, but it doesn't really work. That's because it's activating itself. We're activating the alpha GPC, the L-theanine.
You're giving it the other things it needs to turn on in the brain and cause the chain reaction.
Exactly. And to my knowledge, there's never been an activation complex like this before, ever. That's why the chemist was so blown away. He said, wow, you're really going
to... And the chemists all love us because no one wants to let them do their cool ideas because they all are so cheap. They want to just have marketing and have some, you know, woman in perfect shape up there and say it did it for them.
Exactly. And it's also a weird thing, too, because most people think if they're taking a certain compound, right, that like the alpha GPC, that that's actually what's doing it for them. They've already found out that it's actually a different compound that crosses the blood-brain barrier, that it is increasing this specific compound into the blood-brain barrier. All of these do that as well. So there's never been a...
So really, you already had the other thing in you. Now you take that, it triggers it.
Exactly.
So you put them all in there together, it makes sure it works.
Yes. And there's some products, some ingredients as well that increase dopamine, which is the feel-good chemical. So some people, for example, a graphic designer and some other people I gave it to, they were not even more about the energy. They just said, like, I just feel happy. I just feel good. You know, I feel like clean good, like a clean energy, a clean happiness, as opposed to something like you get with an energy drink or one of those.
That are basically artificial drugs. They order the brain to feel like it, but it isn't the natural feeling.
Right. This just increases the compounds you already have. The production.
This is what you're actually designed to run on.
Exactly.
It's kind of like a car will run on one form of junkie gas, but it runs really good on what it's designed for.
And that's the principle of InfoWars Life, as far as I understand, that you've always had, is that it's not about synthetic chemicals and forcing actions. It's about letting your body do its own thing and giving your body the tools it needs to create these different compounds that are super valuable and super beneficial. And that's why, of course, in the EU, one of these ingredients is considered a drug, because it actually lets your body do its own thing. It's really, really powerful stuff. And I'm pretty sure that this will be one of the new flagship products for InfoWars Life. There's no question in my mind this will be a bestseller. And I think it was a mess up. Like the chemist told us, we should have ordered more in the beginning. And he was excited about it. And now I realize why. Taking it, it's pretty evident to me. And I think that's also why you've been having such good shows lately, too. I remember we talked about it earlier. Your shows have been super powerful.
And I wanted to tell people, but we weren't ready yet. I mean, it's really helping me.
Yeah, I mean, oftentimes...
My problem is I don't take my own products. I've never been a vitamin mineral supplement taker, so now I kind of sporadically do it, and we're trying to get where I always take it. I'm getting better. And then it just is amazing. InfoWarsLife.com. Hey, bottom line, you're supporting InfoWars that promotes the Second Amendment, freedom, you name it, by purchasing this. Get it, try it out for yourself. I can't wait till the reviews come in on this. InfoWarsLife.com, announcing Brain Force. At InfoWarsLife.com. It is simply the most powerful brain activation formula out there. High-quality water filtration that cuts out the glyphosates and sodium fluoride that they're putting in there to sterilize us and dumb us down on record. Fund the operation to fight the enemy while we help people. The globalists take your money forcibly with tax money and then use it to shut down your jobs. See, we're the opposite of them. Plus, super high-quality products at low prices. People love you. They become your customers. You're successful the old-fashioned way, like a restaurant that has really good food and that cleans its kitchen so folks don't get food poisoning and stop coming to you. I mean, you know, but the globalists, again, have been insulated from liability. That's why you see it getting so crazy. So we also know we have massive liability, not just that I want to have high-quality, game-changing products. That's the real reason. But that's why doing the right thing under God's plan is the way to go. Because then we have the protection because it's high quality. It's all double checked and tested, the best labs in the country. It's great. It's affordable. It's competitive. It funds our operation. It's a win-win, the old-fashioned Americana way. Brain Force. Now, we're going to spend a few more minutes on this. Anthony's going to stay with us and shift gears into the terrorism alerts. I haven't gotten to the police just absolutely hiring more and more psychotic thugs. We're going to play some audio and video that's some of the most shocking I've seen in a while. But Anthony, I bumble on here. Get into all your research. Get into what the ingredients are that we think within a year they're already looking at making drugs here and not even letting us have this product. So that's why Brain Force is so amazing. And I can't believe there's been a screw up by whoever that we only have a little bit of it. And that's the truth. Watch, it'll be sold out for a while. Tell us what's in Brain Force and then get into these news articles right here about what's happening.
And I know you want to get into the news. I just had to bully you into talking about it for a minute because this is actually, I'm really excited about it because I don't think anyone has had the guts before to put this much power into a formula for brain health before that I've found. And specifically now, some of these things that most people don't know about. And they don't know about them because we have the research and we know it's good for brain health. And they're already using it for Alzheimer's and stuff like that in some cases. But of course, it's not a hot topic. I mean, how could the big pharmaceutical companies make money off this stuff, right? Because, I mean, we're selling it at an affordable price of $30. So first thing I'm going to talk about is phosphatidylserine. And that's responsible for a lot of things, but specifically it's the cell structure of the brain. And that ties into the fact that the TV watching that's lowering IQ and making kids stupid in general isn't just because they're in a trance and they're kind of just out of it for a
little bit. No, it admits it causes cellular death. Major study last week.
It changes the cellular structure of their brain. Right.
It changes the wiring, and once it rewires, the brain is designed to necrose in the areas not being used.
Exactly. And why have you never heard about this compound before, phosphatidylserine? Because it actually helps the cell structure of the brain. That's why we put it in there. And then the other thing I'm going to talk about is hyperzine A. Okay, and hyperzine A. Oh, by the back, go for a second.
By the way, let's stop. Nico actually wanted to come on air. Nico's the head producer, and they're doing a great job. Nico, I hadn't told anybody about this because it sounds so wild. I didn't know if I was going to do it, but why not? You've noticed a difference the last 3 weeks. I've been on this 3 weeks religiously. And before, I was just trying it out here and there because I'm not good at taking pills. You've noticed a difference. Go ahead.
Yeah, I didn't realize that you were taking any supplements, but I've absolutely noticed that you've been way more focused the past 2 weeks.
You mean brain supplement? You didn't know I was on Brain Force.
Yeah, the brain supplement. You've had a pep in your step, and you've been getting here early, and you've been focused on the news more than you have been in a long time, and it's been really awesome.
Well, the listeners are noticing. I mean, I'm still my same old stuttering crazy person, but I mean, it really does work, Nico.
Yeah, I'm going to have to get a bottle when we get it back.
Absolutely. Well, yeah, the trucks just got here. That's why we're launching it today. It was coming tomorrow. Thank you so much, Nico. Anything else you want to add, Nico?
I'm good.
All right. He was just saying that during the break.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. Go through what's in it.
This phosphatidylserine stuff, right? It works for the cell structure of the brain. And for a long time, people have been using it. But guess how they had to use to get it? They had to go into a dead cow and dissect its brain, extract it from the cow's brain. Okay? Now we get it from cabbage. So that's the extent they were going to protect themselves and get this phosphatidylserine. They were going to dead cow's brains and extracting it.
That's not smart, but smart because of
mad cow disease,
spongiform encephalopathy.
Yep, and now we get it from cabbage. And then there's hyperzine A, and this is the compound that I'm pretty sure they're going to turn into a pharmaceutical drug.
Well, see, listen, 10 years ago, before I started getting burnt out, I would not be able to say the name of the mad cow prion. But now that I'm on this, and it's definitely this, I'm like, my photographic memory is coming back. It's amazing.
We've all been dumbed down, whether we know it or not. Whether we actively engage in eating bad, there's always hidden additives in your food. Even organic food has hidden additives. I mean, we're looking at the television screen, at least, you know, for research purposes or whatever we're even doing, trying to learn something or staring at the computer all day, working, doing good. You're still damaging your brain. Ultimately, we've all been dumbed down to some degree, you know, and that's why it's so empowering to have all these things.
Race through the other ingredients. List them all.
All right. There's hyperzine A. Okay. And it's so powerful. It's being heavily researched now by Big Pharma because they want to turn it into a top selling drug, which I believe it will be. And this increases it's called acetylcholine. All right. And this is the chemical that all of these, the puzzle of Brain Force ultimately does is it increases this acetylcholine in your brain. It doesn't give you artificial amounts of it, increases the development of it in your brain. And this,
we always go for what makes your body trigger it, not the fake synthetic that copies it.
Exactly.
Because that messes up your own receptors.
Yes. And this acetylcholine is the thing that connects our nerves and allows us to send signals. So that's why people with Alzheimer's have issues with acetylcholine. They're not functioning at their highest level because their acetylcholine levels are often decreased. And when you can
Which statins shut down those.
Yeah. When you can increase it, though, that's when you have some award-winning stuff. And that's why they're taking this hyperzine A, and they're already starting to say, we might have to switch this over to a pharmaceutical drug. And that's our concern. Because
if the others.
Pharma gets it, then it's over, right? We have yerba mate leaf powder. You love yerba mate. That's one of the
major. That's part of the very, very clean pep.
Want that in there. The L-theanine I talked about. The alpha GCP also increases the acetylcholine. And then we have the vitamin B12. And here's the difference, too. We also have the super high-powered Secret 12, which is obviously going to be the best source of B12. But this is the same. Methylcobalamin in a small dose. And what that does is it ties the rest of it together. Because we've found when you have these individually, like I said, a little bit of
that's why my medical doctor gave me methylcobalamin. I hate needles, but needles are so small to inject. When I had my physicals 8 months ago and whatever, and I have a prescription to it, and I take it every few days, is he said you have to have all this to be able to have your hormones be produced and be able to absorb all these vitamins you're taking.
Right. I mean, B12's important for the adrenal glands. It ties everything together. Not to mention the cell formation, which is the same as the hyperzine A and the phosphatidylserine. So all these things are congruently working together, and that's what is most...
And you go to the store, almost every B12 is not methylcobalamin because it costs 10 times more, right. Literally.
It's cyanocobalamin, which is the cyanide-based synthetic form. And that is exactly what the chemist told us. He said, look, congratulations, you're the only guy that I know is using that's using methylcobalamin in a brain formula.
Not we're not... In fact, we probably get these people on. We are worshipped by the manufacturers because these are the top good organic folks we go to, and they go, thank you. No one wants to put this out of hundreds of people they supply. I mean, this one company supplies, I don't want to say it, but Walmart, everybody.
Yeah. And they say, look, cyanocobalamin is a cyanide derivative. Are you sure? You know, they tell these people, are you sure you want the cyanocobalamin? It's from cyanide. And they still say yes. But then again, these are the same people sweeping up herbs from the floor and putting them back on the conveyor belt. Right. So we just have a higher quality standard, and we're not ever going
to. And we're not doing this to bash our competition. No. It's true. Because I'll tell you, I would just buy from the competition if cheap was good and sell that and private label it.
Well, we tried that. Remember, we looked. I don't know how many people we've contacted. Hey, we want to work with you, blah, blah, blah. And then we look at their stuff and we can't actually do it because of moral reasons. I mean, we can't sell certain things because they're too low quality. It's come down to us making all of it, pretty much every single thing. And we sell one thing, Oxy powder, that's not under the InfoWars Life brand. That's it.
And it's a phenomenal product, but out for a decade. InfoWarsLife.com. What are these headlines over here?
You know, this is some more stuff. There's just so much. This study called The Effects of Fast-Paced Cartoons looked at people watching SpongeBob for a period of 7 to 9 minutes and then tested them against people that did not watch SpongeBob. And the people that watched SpongeBob performed poorly, way more poorly compared to those that did not.
Well, why did the head of Apple, before he died, they said, you know, what kind of iPad do your kids have? He says, I don't let them have any computers.
Yep, Steve Jobs, yeah.
And they said, why? And he goes, it brain damages you.
Exactly, because what they found is that, let's say like you're playing a guitar or a flute or whatever, you progress, right? Like once you learn one song, you get better at the next one, or once you learn how to forage berries for a more primal example, you get better and you forage more berries.
Once you fight, TV, you fight better.
You know, TV is a plateau. There's no increase or decrease. You don't have any actual...
Well, they're in a race to have it lower and lower attention span to keep you. And that's why it's all frenetic. Because it's just meant to sit, but that fries your brain literally.
Especially for kids. And you said, it's like a goldfish. And earlier you read the story that kids now and Americans in general, adults have less attention span than a goldfish.
And a goldfish has the lowest attention span, period.
Yes. So we literally are flipping.
It's like Finding Nemo with, well, what's the name of the fish that doesn't?
I don't know.
I know the seagulls go, mine. That's
Yeah.
Oh, man, I'm ranting here, ladies and gentlemen. All right, InfoWarsLife.com. We're not kidding. It's kind of bittersweet, though, because I bet this sells out in 3 days with the amount you guys got. Why did you? I can't keep track of everything. That is a real ball dropper.
It was not a good move, for sure.
I mean, we've been working on this for a year.
A little more than that.
I mean, it is a sales gimmick to say something's going to sell out, but you notice 4 products are sold out.
Well, you know, that's the other thing, too. You do say the products are going to sell out when they do sell out. Liver Shield is sold out. It's completely sold out. It might not even be here for 1 to 2 months. We've been sold out of Prostagard. We've been sold out of Childies. We've been sold out of all of those. It's not a gimmick. It is sold out. It's been sold out for, like, months.
People say, why don't you just get more? Because we don't have the money to buy a big enough stockpile to have it sit there.
Because we don't buy products for 10 cents a bottle where they just import crap from China. We have high quality.
It's hard for them to line up getting it all. Then it all has to be triple tested by the lab. Then we test again, even though that's not the law, because we know we have enemies and stuff that are tracking everything. So we keep bottles at the factory and here in case someone ever spikes it to set us up,
yep,
as we've been threatened to do. Don't think we're not aware of that. I mean, we're neurotic. Praise God, we've got a lot of angles covered here. Oh. We're just winners, and our enemies don't like it. I mean, they hate the fact we're funding InfoWars by not taking your tax money like MSNBC or CNBC. I mean, they literally get taxpayer money. We don't support our local AM/FM affiliates. That is just as important as buying these products from us, is become a sponsor of that local station today. Buy from them, whether it's Albuquerque or whether it's Knoxville or whether it's Austin. Or whether it's Orlando or whether it's Chicago, support that station, spread the word, thank their sponsors, become a sponsor. InfoWarsLife.com. InfoWarsHealth.com for the family of longevity products that are excellent as well. That's why I work with them. Over 400 products. I've vetted over 100 of them, so I can't vouch for everything. I know they're a very upstanding company, and the ones we promote at InfoWarsHealth.com are super high quality as well. And you can get free shipping there when signing up for AutoShip. 30% discount the first time you sign up to be a distributor. $10 fee. InfoWarsHealth.com. Don't want to forget them as well. They have phenomenal products. The only other product I know of that has the biggest bang for the buck would be Beyond Tangy Tangerine. But there are others that are excellent as well. Now let's get into the other news. Anything else you want to add about this? I mean, you just got into one of your articles about the...
There's a lot, but I think we're ready to move forward on it. I mean,
you're going to get into everybody's on these drugs to knock their brain out because the brain's so fried, only makes it worse. Look at Xanax.
So, you know, Xanax and Ambien. How many people do you know that are on Xanax or Ambien? A lot. I personally know multiple people, right?
Most of the women you run into are.
Unfortunately, what people think and their doctors tell them is that, well, you just take a Xanax every now and then and you'll feel a little better. But then every now and then, every once a month turns into 5 times a month, 10 times a month, every single day.
And that doesn't work, so they start giving you 2 or 3 more drugs.
What happens is, of course, people aren't addressing the root issues in their lives, and they're upset about it, and they have no passion, and they have no will to live, and some of them are suicidal because they have no purpose. They don't live a purpose-driven life. And what happens is they take Ambien or they take Xanax every day, and their memory is going to be destroyed. You're going to have memory loss, and you're going to have dementia. And this is from AARP, of all places, from 2012. So we've known this more than a decade.
And it gives you cancer. I mean, it's all come out.
Of course, right? And people get dependent on them, just like painkillers. And they get their brain structure is ruined because they can't face the issue they have. Unfortunately, it's very sad. So they dumb themselves down. And then when they dumb themselves down, they get used to a limited state of brain functioning. And in this limited state of brain functioning, they don't have to face their issues maybe as much, and they could sleep or whatever it is. But that limited state stays permanent. And their memory is destroyed, and they're not able to function as human beings.
Basically a lobotomy.
It is a lobotomy. And, of course, the doctors don't tell them, hey, well, what if you do this, or what if you actually give value?
Go climb a hill. Go do charity. I mean, all of this shows that, because you're meant to have a purpose. Your brain, you don't have a purpose, but nihilistic pleasure, which is fun for a while. I mean, believe me, I'm not a saint in my life. Mm-hmm. It is not fulfilling.
No.
I mean, I was in college, had all these really hot girlfriends, the rest of it. It was not fulfilling. God was fulfilling. Having children was fulfilling. Helping people was fulfilling. And it's because we're purpose-driven. If you don't have a purpose, you're not helping people, your body starts shutting off because you're not needed. I mean, it's that simple. They've cut open the brains of like 90-year-old famous composers. They're shriveled, they're tiny, but the people were geniuses when they died because what was there in brain mass was all wired properly, and they were purpose-driven. It's just like the physical exercise. If you don't exercise, you're going to weigh 400 pounds. You're going to die of a heart attack when you're 45. If you're purpose-driven and exercising, you're going to be dynamic and live to 85.
And if you watch TV, your mind is going to have literal gray matter everywhere, and you're not going to develop any systems to actually do anything. And that's the other thing, too, like you just said, is people go to the doctor, and they don't ever tell them to actually give value. All these people want to take value. They want to watch TV and absorb. They want to absorb the media.
They want to take and not give.
Exactly. They don't want to give anything. But
giving is what makes you strong.
The only way they'll feel better.
I mean, I went in and bench pressed. I'm finally getting strong again. You know, 245 pounds. I was getting 10 reps of it. Saturday went and worked out when I was up in Kalamazoo at the gym there in the Radisson. Really nice Radisson. Nicest Radisson I ever saw, but that's a side issue. And it's like this attitude of, oh, that's heavy. I got to do work. And it was fun to do it. And it gave me something to lift that weight.
Well, what is exercise? It's pushing out, isn't it? I mean, it's exerting force. People that don't exercise, don't do anything, don't give anything to life or society or the planet.
What do the globalists in that Pentagon report admit on mastering the human domain? They say, we're worried about empowered individuals. Not about terrorists, not about empowered individuals. That's what threatens them, Anthony.
Oh, I bet. I mean, just look at the new media, which is social media. On there, you have millions of followers who spread everything you say, and they're super, super powered up, and they get value from that because they know they're helping people. They're going to spread this video, and they're going to help people, and they're going to have value in their lives.
And our enemy is in there always saying, you're failing, you're nothing, nobody listens to you, right. Wanting to disempower. They're desperate.
Of course.
They're like, shut them down, demonize them. What are you doing? But all the elite have are just masses of drones.
They have nothing but suppressive technology and suppressive acts. Nothing they do gives any value. They're afraid of value, and they're afraid of people sharing these videos and sharing the articles on InfoWars and everything like that, because that puts things out and gives value. The people that detract and attack, all they do is try to steal value, like value vampires.
That's how the universe, all these losers that will help that then backstabbeth, they don't understand. I always did it because it was the right thing to do, but now I understand it's the secret of the universe. You give out good, it comes back to you.
Right.
And but it's not some magic thing like name it and claim it, pray and you'll get it. No, go out, be a good person, take action for the right reason, and then the universe opens up.
They're value vampires because it's the same people that go on InfoWars all day and comment and troll on everybody. They're just stealing value. They're not putting anything out. Who cares about them, right? The people that matter are the things.
Yeah, then they never criticize us effectively saying, here's a better way to do it or here's my idea. It's just attack the crab trying to get out of the bucket. We'll be back, ladies and gentlemen. I got to get into these cops. I'm going to do some overdrive. I got to get into the terror alert. Stay with us. They're funding ISIS. They're running it. They don't command them, but they're funding them and turning them loose and letting them recruit all over the Western world. It's just outrageous criminal activity. And when they attack, they'll take more of our rights. And when I fly, the TSA will want to grope my genitals and put me through a naked body scanner. I'm not even blaming the TSA people themselves. They're victims as well. They're in there baking inside the radiation rooms. And they lie to them and tell them it's fine for them, even though they have cancer clusters. And we all have to have our genitals groped or whatever and take our shoes off and put our hands up like we're prisoners while the government funds Al-Qaeda publicly. And then they can have the former CIA deputy director on CBS saying he, you know, wouldn't be surprised by an attack. Here's that clip.
Routinely. But there's nothing routine about this particular one to me. This one really resonates with me for two reasons. One is there's been about 50 people in the last 12 months who've been arrested in the United States for being radicalized by ISIS, wanting to go fight there or wanting to conduct an attack here.
And they're not wound
up by the FBI.
There's a lot
of people out there who are seeing themselves as aligned with ISIS, number one. And then number two, you have this ISIS call to arms during Ramadan. We are right in the middle of Ramadan.
Oh, yeah, they're going
to call
attack.
To arms, conduct attacks against our enemies. So I'm worried about this one.
What does this mean for Americans on 4th of July?
Yeah. I don't want to tell Americans what to do or what not to do. But, Nora, I wouldn't be surprised if we're sitting here a week from today talking about an attack over the weekend in the United States. That's how serious this is.
And see, they don't have to stage it this time because this isn't synthetic with the former, you know, with the grandson of the former head of the ADL commanding Al-Qaeda, Adam Gadon. I mean, how done they think we are. They've actually created a 200-man-plus army, 200,000-plus-man army. They've allowed them to get oil fields, you name it. They've left them alone. They're allowed to fly back and forth. They've allowed them to come in. They bet you're so stupid and the media is so controlled that when they attack, no one will say, why'd you create them? Why'd you bring them in? And that's why they hate us, because we're going to be here pointing it out. And you can try to kill me or shut me up. The word's already out. So don't allow your people to attack. Here's the problem. They don't completely control these yahoos. These ISIS groups are not the standard mentally ill person that the government winds up to go out and do something. So the FBI gets a collar and gets to be on the news. This is real. And I've been telling you that for about a year, and now you see it. I'm not saying there'll be an attack 4th of July, but they're building up towards it to take our liberties and freedoms. I'm going to do some overdrive and get into the police and how they're trying to hire mental patients to fill their ranks. Stay with us. Kit Daniels brought me this bombshell article during the last break, and I just didn't get to it, and I've got this other news I need to get to, but it's so over the top. Obama removes TPP's anti-slavery clause, then attacks Confederate flag, a symbol of slavery. Hypocrisy. Obama defends slavery, then attacks Confederate flag for its ties to slavery. And one of the subsections on the TPP that he admittedly now has signed on to is removing an anti-slavery human trafficking clause for countries like Dubai and others. And for folks that don't know, Dubai was built by slaves. Those Arab countries basically have slaves in them right now. But it's okay because they're, you know, they're Muslims, they're foreigners. It's kind of cute when they have women in chains and chop Christians' heads off. It's like a trendy thing. I mean, they smoke hookahs, so the trendies all smoke hookahs. I mean, you know, the problem's the West that produced the end of slavery and women's freedom. I mean, we're bad because we're actually good people and can be bludgeoned over the head into submitting to tyranny by being told, support Obamacare, you're a racist scumbag. Now, I'm going to talk more about this tomorrow because there's three of these videos. I never got to them. But video, maniac cop straps handcuffed man to chair and tortures him for resisting. The guy never resists except when he's stomping on him. The guy kind of pushes back to protect himself. The media even admits it's involuntary. The other cops who are with him say, hey, this is being filmed, you better stop. They restrain him in a chair. He starts beating him more. That's just some middle-aged guy they were taking in. And they're just hiring these people. When I was growing up, they wanted to hire tough guys to be cops that were really tough guys, because on average, a really tough guy doesn't want to just beat people up for no reason. They want to hire the phony tough. And they got the phony tough, the crazy brave. And I've been arrested for demonstrating at the Travis County. Had a classic 5-foot-tall redhead guy, like 5'3". And I'm not that tall. I'm 5'11". I don't have some little guy syndrome, though. Ram my head in the wall and say, you want to do something? Had it happen in New York. I wasn't smarting off, wasn't doing jack crap. They wanted me to have a reflex so they could hurt me bad. Now, that's sadomasochistic. That's sadistic, not sadomasochistic. And that's what fills the dungeons of history. And they're trying to get people in like this to complete our journey to totalitarianism. And then they know we're angry about it, so they want to blame the whole government corruption on cops, start a war with them that will drive them into deeper gang mentality. When the average cop does not act like this. Okay? I mean, that's just true. I've been around the country. I've seen it. On average, cops are more awake than anybody but the military. So they're a natural ally locally if we just don't get played. But we've got to go after the bad cops, and that's starting to happen. I got 3 articles a day where they're getting in trouble for their crimes. Here's part of this video in Colorado, in Federal Heights. Now let's go to that video.
The 9-minute video starts with Federal Heights officer Mark Magnus pulling the suspect from a patrol car, and just a minute and a half later, slamming him into the door. The man's nose now dripping with blood. Things escalate again inside the cell. Watch as the man swats at officer Magnus, sending him into a rage.
That's one he's beating.
The attack lasts more than 10 seconds, but it's not over. The suspect now pinned, Magnus flies into a rage. Another officer even tries to warn him he's being recorded. The man is thrown into the chair.
Nothing else. I'm sorry, sir.
Magnus presses into his eyes and temples and accusing him of resisting as they strap him into the chair.
Stop resisting. You understand me?
For Dennis Disqua, the video is deja vu.
When he just grabbed me, I didn't resist nothing. And just he pushed me and threw me all the way down.
In 2009, he says Officer Magnus broke his arm when he threw him to the ground and then left, refusing to get him help. Magnus pleaded guilty to a misdemeanor
charge. Magnus just looks like a total wimp that wants to be tough.
On the force.
He ought to get in a boxing ring. These guys that are so tough, why don't you go get in a jiu-jitsu club or a ring where there are people that actually want to learn how to train and learn life skills? They will rip you apart. And, of course, the cops that are at the boxing clubs and stuff are cool people. I'm telling you, it is the guys that are like this that are the problem, and they're a reflection of the thugs we have in control. The crap rolls downhill, the fish rots from the head, and if you let bad cops like this continue, you're going to be scapegoated police departments. You endanger the whole country allowing this. And the good news is he's been indicted and in trouble. All right, we're out of time. Nightly News tonight, 7 o'clock Central. Powerful transmission. Good job, crew.